A very good morning to everyone assembled here. Novelty for us is excitement and exuberance, surprise and science, cheerfulness and joy, hope and happiness, boldness and buoyancy, positiveness and passion. I welcome you all to this beautiful morning for this webinar on popular literature and culture conducted by Department of English, Gregorian College of Advanced Studies. It is a mark of our undying tradition to invoke the Almighty at the beginning of an important event. I request Arjun G.S. from Essex MBA English for the prayer.
കണ്ണിമയ്ക്കാത്ത കാവലാളായി കാത്തിടു ദൈവമേ, കരുണയാകുന്ന കാന്തിയാലെന്നെ പുൽകുമാരാകണേ. കനവിലും എൻ്റെ നിനവിലും നിൻ്റെ സ്നേഹമേകേണമേ, കഴലിണ നിൻ്റെ വഴിയിലായ്ചീരം നീങ്ങുമാറാകണേ. നന്മ എന്നുള്ളിൽ ഒളിവുമങ്ങാതെ പൊഴിയുമാറാകണേ, നന്മ എന്നുള്ളിൽ ഒളിവുമങ്ങാതെ പൊഴിയുമാറാകണേ. നല്ലതായുള്ളതെന്തിനോടുമെൻ മനസ്സു ചേരേണമേ, നല്ലതായുള്ളതെന്തിനോടുമെൻ മനസ്സു ചേരേണമേ. കണ്ണിമയ്ക്കാത്ത കാവലാളായി കാത്തിടു ദൈവമേ.
Thank you, Arjun. A ray of light is a ray of hope. Let's all leave the darkness and step towards the bright path. I request Dr. R. Gopakumar, Head of Department of English, to formally welcome the gathering.
Good morning, everybody. The president of this session, our respected principal, Dr. K.C. George, college administrator, Reverend Father Joseph Chacko, respected resource person, Ms. Kaikasi V.S., heads of departments of our college, Dr. Philip, head of the Department of Economics, Dr. Sheila Irene, the head of the Department of History, Ms. Carolyn, HOD in charge, Department of Commerce, the other members of the faculty, Mr. Sabrinath, the coordinator of this webinar, Mr. Arjun G.S., my dear students, I feel extremely happy that we have arranged a webinar on popular literature and culture even during the days of this pandemic. All of us know that we are passing through difficult days. But we have to march forward. Whatever may be the difficulty that we confront, we have to develop enough determination. We have to gather enough courage to confront the adverse situations in life. At the same time, we cannot give up our constant pursuit of knowledge. We have to know more about human life. We have to know more about literature, and we have to know more about human culture. This is a moment of great pride, not only to the Department of English, but to the whole college, because we have succeeded in organizing a seminar on a very relevant topic, especially a topic which is relevant to the students of the first semester of the English language and literature. Unfortunately, we have got an ideal person to deliver the keynote address to. On this auspicious occasion, this meeting is being presided over by our respected principal, Dr. K.C. George. Dr. K.C. George needs no introduction to this fraternity, to the students. Most of you may know that he is a good teacher, an eminent academician, and an outstanding administrator. He always keeps his calm and cool. But when it comes to the implementation of decisions, he is very strict and he is very vigilant about it. It is to be noted that he has produced 8 PhDs and is currently working on completing the 9th one. On behalf of the Department of English and on behalf of the college, for that matter, I extend a very warm welcome to you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Reverend Father Joseph Chacko is known to all of us. Each and every student must be familiar with Reverend Father Joseph Chacko. And the first thing that I would like to point out when I talk about our father is the unique administrative acumen that he exhibits. when it comes to the administration of the college, he has an eye even for the minutest details. And he is familiar with each grain of sand in this campus, leave alone the question of human beings. And it is his administrative talent that has enabled us to work in a conducive atmosphere here. On behalf of the Department of English and on behalf of the organizing committee of this function and on behalf of the college, I extend a hearty welcome to you, Father.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
As I told you earlier, today we are conducting a webinar on popular literature and culture. And I have already mentioned that we have got an ideal resource person to deliver the keynote address. And I would like to take this opportunity to welcome our chief guest of the day and the resource person, Ms. Kaikasi V.S. She is currently working as Assistant Professor of English, University College, Thiruvananthapuram. She is the recipient of the prestigious Best Young Educationalist Award, instituted by the Rotary Club International in 2015. She has also to her credit several articles, both in English and in Malayalam, published in peer-reviewed journals and other publications. She has made more than 35 paper presentations, both at the national and at the international levels. She has also been invited as a resource person for several training programs. She has authored a number of articles in the field of literature, sociology, and film studies. Her area of research is Indian mythology, and she is equally interested in translating literary works in her mother tongue. Moreover, she is an accomplished creative writer and bilingual translator whose poems have appeared in several national and international anthologies, including The Poetry of Flowers. She has also contributed to Indian literature, the bi-monthly journal published by the Sahitya Academy. In 2017, she was awarded the Most Inspiring Teacher title by the New Indian Express. And today, she is going to speak to us on the topic entitled When Shakespeare Meets Bob Dylan, an introduction to popular literature and culture. With these words, I extend a very warm welcome to Ms. Kaikasi.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you for your lovely
welcome.
Words. Good morning to one and all present here.
Teacher, I have to welcome 2-3.
Okay, sir.
Okay. So, sorry for the interruption. I cannot but make a mention of the pains taken by Mr. Sabarinath, who is a member of the faculty, and he is a coordinator of this webinar. It was he who took the initiative to convene this seminar. And on behalf of the Department of English, on behalf of the college and on my personal behalf too, I welcome Mr. Sabarinath to this webinar. I would like to thank Mr. Arjun G.S., who has set the ball rolling in an appropriate manner by singing a sweet prayer. And last but not the least, I would like to welcome my dear students to this webinar, and I hope that all of you will get benefited by this exercise. Wish you all good day. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Now I cordially invite Dr. K.C. George, Principal of Gregorian College, for the presidential address.
Respected Chief Guest, Ms. K.C. D.S., Assistant Professor of English, University College, Trivandrum. College Administrator, Reverend Father Joseph Chaco. Head of the Department of English, Dr. Gopakumar. Other heads, dear teachers, and my dear students. Being a student of physical science, I have only limited exposure to English language and literature. In the morning, Sabarinath came to me and I asked him, what is this popular literature and culture? He gave me an introduction. I think popular literature is primarily designed for entertainment of the masses. And in this particular category, predominant emphasis is on the story or the plot rather than the manner in which it is told. I remember during my degree class, I studied Pride and Prejudice. It came under the class of romance. Actually, I think it is a popular literature. Then Crime and Punishment by Dostoevsky. All this comes under, I think, in the category of popular literature. Now I remember, I am from Sangasheri, and a Malayalam writer, Muttathu Varki, he is a popular writer in Malayalam, and through his writings, the habit of reading is enhanced among the public. So this popular, one of the advantages of popular literature is that the habit of reading is enhanced in the society. So this is a very very good and characteristic of this popular literature. So if popular literature can enhance the reading habits, then it is the popular literature will be welcomed. And I wish all success to this particular webinar. And on behalf of the college, on my personal, I welcome the chief guest of this function, Ms. K.C., who is an apt person for this particular webinar, Popular Literature and Culture. I am concluding. Thank you all.
Thank you, sir. Certainly, your address goes a long way in inspiring us. Next, I would like to call upon Reverend Father Joseph Chacko, Administrator of GCAS, for the inaugural address.
Respected Principal Dr. K.C. George, sir, our Chief Guest, Kaigasi V.S., Head of the Department, Dr. R. Govumar, sir, in this program, Chief Coordinator, Sabrinadas, our teachers, dear students, good morning to one and all. Adime thanne ee oru samarambathine ella vidhamaya aashamsakalum nerigiyana. Adhigarikamayi ithine kurichu adhigam parayan njan aalalla. Engilum university-yude syllabus prakaramulla maattangal അത് കുട്ടികൾ നന്നായി അറിയുക, അതിനെക്കുറിച്ച് മനസ്സിലാക്കുക, ടീച്ചേഴ്സ് ഉൾപ്പെടെ അത് അറിയാനും മനസ്സിലാക്കുവാനും ശ്രമിക്കുക, അതിന് ഇത്തരം വെബിനാർ ഉപകാരമാകട്ടെ, പ്രയോജനപ്പെടട്ടെ എന്ന് ഞാൻ ആദ്യമായി പ്രാർത്ഥിക്കുകയും ആശംസിക്കുകയും ചെയ്യുകയാണ്. കാരണം നമുക്കിന്ന് വളരെ അതിന് കഴിവുള്ള വളരെ പ്രശസ്തയായ കൈകസി വി എസ് ടീച്ചർ നമ്മോടൊപ്പം ഉണ്ട്. ഇംഗ്ലീഷ് ഡിപ്പാർട്ട്മെന്റ് അതിന് വേണ്ട ഇനിഷ്യേറ്റീവ് എടുത്തു. എല്ലാവരെയും ഞാൻ ഈ അവസരം അഭിനന്ദിക്കുകയാണ്. സാഹിത്യ മേഖലകളെ കുറിച്ച് അറിയുവാൻ, വിവിധ സംസ്കാരങ്ങളെ കുറിച്ച് മനസ്സിലാക്കുവാനൊക്കെ വായനയുടെ തലങ്ങളിൽ അതിൻ്റെ പഠന തലങ്ങളിലൊക്കെ അറിവുകൾ കണ്ടെത്തുവാൻ ഈ കരിക്കുലം അല്ലെങ്കിൽ ഈ സിലബസുകൾ ഉപകാരപ്രദമാകട്ടെ എന്ന് ഞാൻ ആശംസിക്കുന്നു. അതിൻ്റെ ആഴങ്ങളിലേക്ക് ഇറങ്ങിച്ചെന്ന് അറിവിൻ്റെ ലോകം വിശാലമാക്കുവാൻ തക്കവണ്ണം പുതിയ സിലബസുകളും അതിൻ്റെ പാഠ്യേതര വിഷയങ്ങളും ഒക്കെ തന്നെ പ്രയോജനപ്പെടട്ടെ എന്ന് പ്രാർത്ഥിക്കുന്നു. ഈ വെബിനാർ ഉദ്ഘാടനം ചെയ്ത ഈ അവസരം അറിയിച്ചുകൊണ്ട് ഞാൻ എൻ്റെ വാക്കുകൾ ഉപസംഹരിക്കുന്നു. താങ്ക് യു.
Thank you, Father. We feel blessed indeed. Finally, it's time to walk with the scholar, to talk with the charmer. I'm profusely elated to take this opportunity to introduce the chief guest of the day, the founding head of Illuminating Ideas, Ms. Kaigasi V.S., Assistant Professor of English, University College, Trivandrum. I heartily invite you, ma'am, for the keynote address.
Good morning to one and all. Thank you so much for your love and all those beautiful words that you have said about me. Before I begin my lecture, I have to place on record my gratitude to two people. One is the head of the Department of English, Dr. Gopumar, who was incidentally my first chief for the external paper evaluation. I remember myself, you know, as a confused teacher who doesn't know what to do with the answer sheets, where to mark and everything. And he was so patient enough to explain to me how it is done. And now I am myself a chief examiner. And whenever I take a paper for chief evaluation, I always remember the tips that he has given about valuing a paper. So it's actually a blessing that you have him as your head of the department. Next, I'd like to place on record my deepest sense of love, gratitude, respect, and whatnot to your young and charming professor, Shabarinath, who is not just a teacher. You know, he's not just a student for me. He is somebody who has always given me bright ideas about looking at literature, and he's a literature enthusiast who has done so much in such a young age. So, you know, therefore, you know, you're doubly lucky to be in a department where these two luminaries are teaching. I love to express my thanks and also for all the beautiful words that you have said by all the other members of the department. Thank you once again. And my lecture is actually divided into, in fact, four parts. primarily, I hope I'm audible. Am I audible? If there is any technical glitches, please do inform me, because, you know, I have made a temporary arrangement because my laptop was not functioning in the morning. So if there is any technical glitch, please inform me. Yes. So, you know, it's a great responsibility. So my lecture is actually divided into four parts. And in the first part, I'm planning to introduce to you what is a canon. Because when you talk about popular literature, you naturally have a concept, or, you know, you should know what canon is. Because on the other side of popular literature, you have canonical literature. So I'll be introducing what is a canon, who determines a canon, and things related to that. Then I'll briefly introduce you to what is popular culture and literature, especially in relation to, popular literature in relation to popular culture. And then I'll be talking about the characteristic features of popular literature and why it was introduced in the first place. Now, I appreciate the efforts taken by the Department of English to actually conduct a webinar like this, not because I was invited, because, you know, it's actually a challenge, because we have a new module in the syllabus. We have a new paper in the syllabus where we are introducing things which normally is not introduced to a student of literature. Perhaps an enthusiast of literature will actually read it, but not a student of literature. Who would have thought that, you know, we'll have to study and write an exam based on Harry Potter, or maybe Game of Thrones, or your latest fads like, you know, Money Heist and all. We never thought that a series will be part of your syllabus. Comics will be part of your syllabus. We never thought that we'll have to study songs by Bob Dylan and John Lennon. For us, these are all outside the, what you call, the mainstream of literature. This happens somewhere in the hinterlands of literature. It is not something that you learn in a classroom, but something that you learn outside the classroom, something that you read for enjoyment, pleasure, as you know, your principal was actually talking about it. It is something that you do for your entertainment. And suddenly all those things that you did for entertainment has become a part and parcel of the syllabus. You'll have to study it, and so on. Now, they always say one of the easiest way to kill the enthusiasm of a student who reads a lot is by introducing all those texts into the syllabus. Just imagine if you had Balarama included in your syllabus, or Kalikuduka being included in your syllabus. Maybe you may not have the same kind of enthusiasm that you have for these texts, because whatever you have to study, you suddenly feel that it is something contrived. It is something very artificial. And that is exactly what we feel when we have a new syllabus being introduced, new paper being introduced into the new syllabus. So how do we go about it? Can we just reject it? Can we say that, you know, no, we will never teach these things, or we will never study these things because they are not pure literature? We cannot say things like that, because there is nothing called pure literature, for the simple reason that there is nothing called pure or raw or sophisticated literature. So you cannot reject it. At the same time, you cannot embrace it and say that this is the only form of literature and every other form of literature will be condemned. So we have to strike a balance in between. So we have to tread a very cautious path in order to understand this paper and approach it with the necessary steps. And primarily, this is what I'll be talking about. Now, we never thought that, as I told you, my lecture is titled When Shakespeare Meets Bob Dylan. We know that Shakespeare and Bob Dylan cannot meet for obvious reasons. But more than that, it is even more surprising that you will be meeting Bob Dylan first and Shakespeare later. That is something which traditional teachers of English literature cannot digest. A student of literature who does not tread the trodden paths of literature, going by a path which actually begins with an introduction to the cultural and the social history of England, followed by some canonical text, Shakespeare, Shaw, and others, you go by that. And then you are introduced to criticism, history of language, you study a bit of phonetics, you learn various other new literatures, post-colonial literature perhaps, but all these things happen at the fag end of your semester or your learning process. But the initial steps, or the baby steps to English language and literature, will always have to be through the path of maybe history of English literature, maybe by learning a bit of Shakespeare, poetry, canonical poets, and so on. So this is the first step that has been broken when PLT is being introduced, when popular culture and literature is being introduced into your syllabus. And that is why we are very cautious about it. Now, there is always a way of looking at it from, you know, from a teacher's point of view and a student's point of view. For instance, all those students who are listening to me or are pretending to listen, you are new to the syllabus. For you, there is no difference because you are born into the syllabus. The first thing that you hear is popular literature. But for teachers like me, was never introduced popular literature in a, what do you call it, in an official or what do you call it, in an academic environment, this is a problem. So for us, it is a big challenge. For students, this is just like sliding into a, or gliding into a system which is already there when they are there. Like when theory was introduced way back, all the teachers were scared, but not the students. For us, it is just another discipline. It's just another paper. But our teachers, you see, you must remember one thing, that when theory was introduced in India or in the Kerala syllabus, it was already widely discussed in other universities. In many universities, they even conducted a symbolic depth of theory. And that is when we introduced it into our syllabus. So there was a hue and cry. We never thought that, you know, this was going to be with us for such a long period. It still continues to be a part and parcel of our syllabus. So this was something which was a kind of an impediment for teachers who are not used to teaching it. So in one way, PLT is not a challenge to the students per se, because for them, it is a very enjoyable experience because they are reading things which they have already read. They are watching things they have already watched, or and they are experiencing things that are new, not new to them. But for teachers, it is a very different experience altogether. So that is why approaching PLT is something which has to be done with caution. It doesn't mean that we have to be scared of it, but a bit of understanding is needed. Many universities and many institutions are yet to come in terms with the fact that they really have to sing a song in the class, probably with a guitar. So, yes, so I'm not here to discuss the pros and cons. You know, you have a group of teachers who are saying that it should not have been introduced at a very early stage in the syllabus, like the first semester and so on. You remember when the grading system was introduced, the students had to study theory. In the first semester, they had to study theory. So many educationalists warned that first, you should learn or have a considerable knowledge of traditional concepts of literature. They should read first and then criticize. So it was later dropped off. And now you have theory and criticism at a later stage of your syllabus. So that is why it is very shocking. That is why you find your teachers being shocked, whereas you are finding the whole thing very, as a, what you call, very enjoyable exercise. My students, they always say, ma'am, let's learn popular literature. Let's learn this, because they are always interested to know things and read things which they are familiar with. Now comes to the, you know, my first part of the lecture. Whatever I said before was just an introduction. I'll be introducing you to the concept of canon. Now, what is a canon? Now, when you say popular literature, it is always has another binary to it. It has an other to it. And that other is the canon. Now, canon originally meant religious, you know, it's guaranteed by religion, especially by the church or by the papal authority. You know, for instance, you have Bible is the canon. And you have so many stories in Bible which are canonical stories, which are passed on from one generation of readers of Bible to another. But there is also the apocrypha, which is not canonical. So you find certain stories in apocrypha not sanctioned by the papal authority or by the church, because they do not believe in that story. The best example of that will be the Gospel of Mary Magdalene. Nobody believes that it was ever written. But still, it actually exists within the system, slightly outside. Now, this is the best example of canon. So you have canon on one side, and everything which is not sanctioned by religion on the other side. This is exactly the nature of canonical literature and popular literature. Now, who determines a canon? who is the authority? Now, that is a question that is often addressed to people when they say, this is a text you'll have to read. See, since you're all new to English language and literature, you know that when you came and joined for this course, somebody must have told you that you'll have to study Shakespeare, you will have that to study, this to study, and so on. Because everybody has got a preconceived notion of what has to be studied and what has not to be studied. So that is something which everybody knows, irrespective of the fact that, you know, whether you are a student of literature or a student of other disciplines, whatever it is, everybody knows that you'll have to go through a similar text and practices. Now, this is what you mean by canon, because, you know, it is already there. There are textbooks which are respected and validated by authorities, and they have been passed on from one generation to another. Questions and tests, everything is based on these textbooks and so on. So that is why it is considered to be appropriate to begin the study of literature. So there are some textbooks like that, especially, you know, texts which are very popular at one point of time, but now have become canonical. Now, in every discipline, you have got these kind of textbooks. Take the case of science. If you want to learn the concepts of science, you have a set of textbooks. Now, this is not a problem when it is in the case of science, where, you know, the concepts are more or less similar. Even in social sciences, having a canonical text is not a problem. So it just, you know, merges with the system. But when it comes to literature, which follows certain abstract principles and concepts, this becomes a problem. Because who is the authority to determine what is good literature and what is bad literature, or badly written books or good written books? Like, you know, Oscar Wilde said, there is no bad literature or good literature. There are only books which are well written and badly written. So who gives you the authority? And also there is this problem of fixing a criteria for selecting a canon. Because, you know, when you say that, you know, I have included this in the syllabus, somebody will ask you, what made you select that textbook? Perhaps they'll say it's because the language is good, the style is exemplified, or, you know, you say that, you know, impeccable language, or they will say that the vocabulary is good, or somebody will say it's because, you know, I like the author. Sometimes that's the only reason, okay? So there are so many reasons why some books are there in your syllabus and some books are not there in your syllabus. So a canon is determined by socio-political changes, sometimes socio-historical accumulations, and so on. Now, in fact, some books which were banned at the beginning of the 21st century, that is to be precise, in the year 2001, you have Penguin Books. They came up with a set of banned books. Now, there is always this charm associated with books which are banned, movies which are banned, and so on, right? The moment somebody tells that this book is banned, what is your immediate reaction? I want to read it. Or when you say that this movie is banned, you will search the whole internet, you search all the Telegram links to watch it. Basically, because human mind is always, you know, is very curious to know what, you know, when somebody tells, don't do it. That is our nature. You know, you can't do anything about it. So Penguin, when they published banned books, you find a number of books which were banned during the time when it was published, which are now considered to be very respectable. And why was it banned at that time? Basically because of religious reasons, some political choices, and the writers, since they were not complying with the authority, some silly reasons, some of the books were banned. Now you have books being banned for several other reasons. I'm not going to the details of that. So exclusion becomes a feature of canon. Some books are excluded. And why are they excluded? Nobody knows. See, really, nobody knows. So when somebody tells this is there and that is not there, there is a reason behind it. And sometimes it is purely personal reasons also. So what is the nature of canons? So You take up the syllabus that has been followed by your great grandfathers, your fathers, you know, in your family. Then you'll understand that most of these texts are written by, one, by males, by white men, and also by heterosexual men. Women are not there. Different sexual orientation, that is not included. Concepts like civil rights, concepts like LGBTQ, these are not included in it. Why? Because the dominant ideology at the time did not believe in these kind of things. So ഇങ്ങനെയുള്ള നമ്മൾ എന്താ പറയുന്നത് മാർജിൻസിലുള്ള ഒന്നിനെയും ഇൻക്ലൂഡ് ചെയ്യാത്ത ഒരു സിസ്റ്റത്തിനെയാണ് നമ്മൾ കാനൺ എന്ന് വിളിച്ചുകൊണ്ടിരുന്നത്. സോ വെനെവർ ദർ ഇസ് റെസിസ്റ്റൻസ് ടു ഓൾ ദിസ് ദേ വർ ജസ്റ്റ് എക്സ്ക്ലൂഡഡ്. ദേ വർ ആക്ച്വലി കൺസിഡർഡ് ടു ബി വർക്സ് വിച്ച് ആർ ഓൺ ദി മാർജിൻസ്. സോ ദാറ്റ് ഇസ് വൺ ഓഫ് ദ ഫീച്ചേഴ്സ്, ദാറ്റ് ഇസ് വൺ ഓഫ് ദ റീസൺസ് വൈ യു ഹാവ് ദ കോൺസെപ്റ്റ് ഓഫ് ഡീ കാനണൈസേഷൻ ടേക്കിംഗ് പ്ലേസ് ഇയേഴ്സ് ആഫ്റ്റർ ദാറ്റ്. ബിക്കോസ് നോ ബഡി വാണ്ടഡ് ടു റീഡ് ബുക്സ് വിച്ച് ആർ പ്യുവർലി റിട്ടൺ ബൈ മെയിൽ. Where are the women? Of course, we had women writers, but they were not included in the syllabus. It was not included in the reading list of universities. When I say universities, these universities included reputed universities like Oxford or Cambridge, from where, you know, women have taken degrees, from where, you know, women were teaching. Even when women were in the mainstream, when they were writing, when they are discussing, when they were in the heights of political activities, their works were not included in the canon. And of course, the white is again, people of color were not included. Even when we say that we have to study Western literature, it was not an inclusive form of Western literature. So a form of studies, or what you call form of text and practices, which was considered, which considered only dominant ideologies, what was prevalent at that time, what was considered to be elite at that time, sophisticated at that time, refined at that time, complying with religious sentiments at that time, all these were part of canon. So you'll be surprised to know that many of the writers who were themselves outside the canon made their way into the canon because of certain kind of allegiances. So that is why I said diversity was not something that was given predominance while selecting a canon. Okay, it was never given a chance. Because diverse voices, plurality of ideas, inclusiveness, all these things were not given any prominence while they were fixing a canon. You call it as a fixing of a canon. Just like, you know, a board of studies fixes your syllabus. Are they studying that? No, they are not studying. So one of the ironical things about the these kind of things is that the adults select things for children to read. Children's literature is actually penned by adults. No child can write a book for themselves. So they decide what is best for the child, and the board of study decides what is best for the students. So we cannot have an alternate system where, you know, you can have students come and, you know, decide what they have to study. It is not possible. It will actually lead to chaos and anarchy. Okay, so it, you know, it's something that you cannot do. So these are things that, you know, occupational hazards of being a student. You cannot choose your syllabus. You cannot say I want to study this and not that. But, you know, at least the people who are deciding this can have a very cosmopolitan attitude towards determining what has to be studied and what not has to be studied. Now, so canonization is not an author's business. That is the primary thing. So when I write a novel, I cannot say, oh my God, my book is going to be included in the canon. And also, there are so many political choices that actually determines the being in a canon or not. For instance, you have Arundhati Roy, when she was not talking about political issues, she was considered to be the blue-eyed girl of Indian media, Indian press, and Indian writers. She was even given the Booker Prize, which is a very prestigious award. But once she started raising voices, her voice, when she actually started making her dissent heard, and she started saying that, yes, I'm an anti-national, you know, the kind of reception her books are given, not by the reading public, but by the political kingmakers or the political kingpins who are actually determining what is best and what is worse for the people. So that is it. So, you know, somebody actually defined what is literature. And they said that literature is something that university professors decide to teach. So what we decide to teach, we, in the sense, people who have a say in the matters, okay, they decide to teach and it becomes part of your literature. So that is why canon is a very problematic concept altogether. It actually talks about so many things, and it is, in one way, it is very good that you have a canon and you have to follow a regular path in order to understand or reach a place where, you know, you can actually see for yourself and discover for yourself what lies outside. So it actually opens up your mind. But there are, in fact, these are the kind of pitfalls of fixing a canon. Now, once a text enters into a canon, it is officially included. It is actually said to be respectable, and it is considered to be something which is sacred, almost sacred. And this actually gives, the feeling that whatever is not there in the canon is not up to the mark. So this is something which, this is a misconception that most of us have. Some people believe that, if you don't get a Nobel Prize for literature, you are not fit to be called a writer, a great writer. If you go by that standards, Leo Tolstoy will not feature into it. You don't find Robert Frost ever winning a Nobel Prize. Or, it's like that. So literary prizes and awards, these are the criteria for some of the canonical works to be there in the, fraternity of textbooks which are prescribed. So that is why it is more than anything else, sometimes a canon is not determined by the quality of the works. For instance, some of the texts that you have to study, you might even actually ask your teacher, sir, why are we studying this? It is rubbish or it is not worth. And your teachers will say, maybe they are rubbish, they are not worth studying, but you have to study because of the historical, political, and the social context in which it is written. I'll give you a very, very simple example, which you'll be soon studying. You have 18th century literature, and before that you have the Restoration literature, which resembles Restoration plays and other things, which actually resembles some of the soap operas of Malayalam. Nammude Malayalam teleserials pole irikkum Restoration age le chila drama lokke vaichu kaniyale. അതായത് അച്ഛനും മോളെ അറിയാം, മോക്കച്ഛനെ അറിയാം, പക്ഷെ ഇവര് രണ്ടുപേരും അച്ഛനും മോളും ആണ്, നാട്ടുകാർക്ക് മൊത്തം അറിയില്ല, അങ്ങനെയൊക്കെ ഉള്ള ഭയങ്കര ഇംപ്രോബബിൾ ആയിട്ടുള്ള സിറ്റുവേഷൻസ് ഉള്ള സീരിയലുകളൊക്കെ നിങ്ങൾ കാണാറുണ്ട്. ഇതിന്റെ ഒരു എക്സ്റ്റെൻഷൻ ആണ് ശരിക്കും റെസ്ട്രേഷൻ ഏജിലെ എല്ലാ പ്ലേയും. ഈവൻ ഇഫ് യു ലുക്ക് അറ്റ് ദി ടൈറ്റിൽസ് ഓഫ് ദി പ്ലേ, യു ഫൈൻഡ് കൺട്രി വൈഫ്, ലവ് ഇൻ എ ടബ്, വെരി വെരി ഫണ്ണി ആൻഡ് ഇൻകോൺഗ്രുവസ് പ്ലോട്ട്സ്. യു ഹവ് സെക്ഷൽ ഇൻവെൻഡോസ്, you have moral profligacy, you have sexual licentiousness. All these are characteristic features of Restoration age, but still you have to study all this. So naturally you will have a question, why are we studying all this? Then your teachers will say, of course you have to get to know what was the cultural sensibility of people who were living at that time, what was the kind of pulse of writers who were writing at that time. Or look at 18th century prose, which is actually if you happen to go through that, you will understand that it is all about political mudslinging. You find one writer slinging mud at another person, the other person retaliating. The whole talent and energy and literary sensibility of the writers were wasted in accusing each other. If you look at, a person like Dryden, I always have sympathetic, feelings for a writer like Alexander Pope. What beautiful talent. Or Jonathan Swift, somebody who has such beautiful or impeccable language. What were they doing in 18th century? They were actually pointing out their fingers at another person. They were criticizing another person. They were fighting with another person. And this was the realm of literature of 18th century. And we call it as the age of reason and prose. That's another thing. Why do we have to study all this? Because unless you read that, you will never be able to understand what was the kind of literary sensibility that was prevailing at that age. Only then you can make a contrast with maybe Romantic age, maybe what was the literary sensibility that was prevailing in the Victorian age, and how is modern age different from all this. So that is why, so even when you have to study things which are not exactly refined or not exactly having literary value, you still have to study these things because it is part of the canon. It is part of the canonical context in which it was selected. So somebody have selected it so that you'll understand that this is a representative work that will give you a glimpse or an idea into what follows. So that is the greatest advantage of having a canon. One of the primary things about a canon is that it is always subject to change. So what is canon now will not be canon tomorrow. And this is actually one thing that many of us miss when we say, when you don't have a particular text to study, you'll immediately say, ഞങ്ങളൊക്കെ പഠിച്ചപ്പോ അതുണ്ടായിരുന്നു, ഇപ്പൊ അതില്ലേ എന്ന് ചോദിക്കുന്നത് ശരിക്കും മണ്ടത്തരമാവുന്നത് അവിടെയാണ്. കാരണം അന്നത്തെ സെൻസിബിലിറ്റി അല്ല ചിലപ്പോൾ നിങ്ങൾക്ക് ഇപ്പോൾ ഉള്ളത്. സോ ദാറ്റ് ഇസ് വൈ ഇറ്റ് ചേഞ്ചസ്, ഇറ്റ് ഇറ്റ് ഇസ് സബ്ജെക്ട് ടു ചേഞ്ച്. Now, sometimes a text becomes canon and sometimes a text goes out of canon. In semantics, you call that by different names. It goes out of relevance. Things that were considered to be so important at one point of time may not hold value to you this time. So, you know, you have to keep that away from the canon. That is again there. Now, you find that most of the writers whom we actually adulate now or value now were not given any value when they were writing at their age. For instance, Charlotte Bronte, when she was, though we claim that Jane Eyre is a classic, to say that it is one novel that you have to read before you die. But when she was writing that novel and when she published that novel, nobody wanted to read that. Or even writers like Virginia Woolf, who is now considered to be an icon in feminist literature and criticism, she was not given the kind of value when she was writing. Or look at even writers like Milton, even when you think of writers like Dr. Johnson, they were not valued and given the kind of veneration that we now give to them from a very different age. So that is again an issue. And also when you say, you know that different readings of the same text happen. For instance, you have Walt Whitman is actually a canonical writer in American literature. And his Song of Myself is now considered not just a poem, but it is also considered to be a cornerstone of gay literature. Because now it is clear. Now, after many years, when you read that, you find that, you know, he had different sexual orientations and maybe he didn't have that, but he was supporting or championing that. So these things become relevant only at a different age. So when they were writing at their age, they were not given the same kind of respect. Or maybe not given the same kind of value. So that is the difference. So you cannot say they were canons at that time, they will remain canons now, and they are going to be canons in the future. You cannot say that, because that is one of the primary features of canon. It is subject to change. So a canon of the past will not be a canon in the future. So that is the one advantage also. So that is why when you say you cannot be very critical about canons. Now, you know, so at one point of times in commerce, you know, we speak about the scale of value. Okay, you say that, you know, when I have a product to be brought in the market, they actually go by the scale of value. What is it? And in education, it is always this contextual reference, you know, and also it is how a particular text is going, or what you call is actually complying with, is agreeing with, basically, with the dominant cultures that were prevalent at that time. You understood? So so that is one of the reasons why some of the text, when you read from the past, you wonder how did the people like this text at that time. That is because that was the dominant ideology at that time. So remember, when you read a novel like, say, Gone with the Wind, you have to understand that this happened when a time when slavery was an accepted part of life, especially for an American household. So when the slave asked the question, where will I go when I have freedom? Now you're surprised. Now you have an answer for that. But, you know, at that point of time, he didn't have an answer for that. The writer, Margaret Mitchell, could not give an answer, because the slave gets up in the morning and tells their master, "Master, I'm free. I'm very happy. I'm free. But where will I go?" So this again becomes a motive. So when you are reading it from, like, you know, you watch old movies of Nasir and, you know, Sheila, and you start laughing, and you laugh and say that, you know, maybe your parents are crying at that time because, you know, they are so moved by the dialogues. But you laugh because you are born into a very different kind of a sensibility. So that is why you cannot fix a canon and say this is going to be a canon forever. That is actually a very foolish or very irrational idea that most of the, the traditionalists would have. And sometimes a canon is fixed so that it becomes a text which tells you this is what you are expected to be. For instance, when you have a novel like Scarlet Letter by Nathaniel Hawthorne in American literature, it is actually in one way saying that, you know, this is the reality. Adultery is something which has to be condemned. So it is actually a preaching book. It is actually a textbook to young women. Or look at Anna Karenina. What will happen when you fall in love with a man when you're already married and having a kid? it might end in your tragedy. Or, you know, look at Tests of the D'Urbervilles by Thomas Hardy. These are all classics, okay, where, you know, it tells you directly that if you're being raped, it's better to die. That is the idea. So looking at it from a 21st sensibility, these novels will be, you know, you can't digest these things, but still you have to read it to understand what the kind of the sensibility of that age. That is the greatest advantage of reading canons. Now, you know that one of the things which is very strange about canons is that, you know, there will be some people who will be selecting all this. I'll you know, you might have heard of this or you will come across this text called Vasari's textbook. I'll read the title: The Lives of the Most Excellent Painters, Sculptors and Architects. Now, in the 16th century, he published it. One of the problems associated with this textbook is that he included painters and sculptors and, you know, literary writers whom he considered to be great, or architects whom he considered to be great. So some of his enemies, people who disagreed with him, did not make it to the list. So as a historical document, if you start looking at Vasari's textbook, you will have some problems, because most of the painters who are considered to be great are not in this collection. Or look at the way in which Addison, in 1694, he actually wrote this book called An Account of Greatest English Poet. Look at the words, okay, greatest. So naturally, you if you are going by it, or you actually think this is the original document which will actually be my guide to understand who are the greatest English poets of the time, you are slightly mistaken, because Addison included only those people whom he considered to be worthy to be included in this collection. So this is a problem with canonical landmarking. You just mark these people and say these are the greatest. So this is the problem. So suppose, you know, if you were to make a contemporary collection of greatest short story writers, I'm sure that most of the writers, young writers, will go and bribe the person who is compiling this, so that, you know, they are also there in it. It becomes a historical document. And why does it happen? It is again because of this over enthusiasm associated with the concept of canon. So whether I'm there in the canon, that is actually a concern of most writers. This is again one of the reasons why you find most of the artists and writers, they do not voice their real concern. Now, you know that, you know, our farmers are striking, and some of the writers and you have the whole concept of propaganda and other things. Why are that some are not reacting to it, or they are silent about it? That basic reason is that they do not want to be excluded from a dominant narrative which is now not actually supporting the farmers. Maybe they are going with the government. So this becomes a propagandist kind of an idea. So that is why I told you canon is determined by a group of individuals who are not perfect, who are flawed in many ways, but that doesn't mean that canon is something that we can discard. So that's one of the reasons. You have other people like, you know, the time is not permitting me to go into that. Harold Bloom and others were great traditionalists who actually prepared a list of writers who have to be read, and some list of writers whom you should not be reading. So that is the irony of the whole thing. And you know that some of the writers whom he prescribed as not to be read are now widely read. That's a tragic irony of it. So Shakespeare is a canon. Mona Lisa is a canon in art. Molly is a canon in drama. Beatles is a canon in pop music. And Citizen Kane becomes a canon in films. So this is how a canon is being made. Remember, when Shakespeare was writing, he was not canon. He was considered to be a popular writer, but now he is a canon. If you go by the definition of a popular writer, it means widely read and makes a lot of money. If you go by this criteria, Charles Dickens and Walter Scott made huge amounts of money when they were writing, but they were popular writers, and now they are canon. So that is why, you know, a canon becomes a popular writer, and a popular writer moves into or glides into the category of being a canon. So many books which were considered to be pulp fiction, paingli novel ennu parayum, ippa korchu munpu sir parna pole muttathu varki popular writer aanu, Bashir popular writer aanu, avarokke canon nattu ippozhaanu ഇൻക്ലൂഡ് ചെയ്യാൻ, അല്ലെ മുട്ടത്ത് വർക്കി എന്ന് ഒരിക്കലും ഇൻക്ലൂഡ് ചെയ്യാനായിട്ടുള്ള ഒരു മനസ്സ് ഇതുവരെയും കാണിച്ചിട്ടില്ല. കാരണം അവരൊക്കെ സാധാരണക്കാരുടെ ഇഷ്യൂസിനെ കുറിച്ച് പറഞ്ഞു, സാധാരണക്കാരുടെ പ്രശ്നങ്ങളെ കുറിച്ച് പറഞ്ഞു. അപ്പൊ അതൊക്കെ എങ്ങനെയാണ് മഹത്തായ സാഹിത്യ കൃതികളിൽ ഉൾപ്പെടുത്താൻ കഴിയാന്നുള്ള ഒരു ചോദ്യം എപ്പോഴും അവശേഷിക്കുന്നുണ്ടായിരുന്നു. സോ ദാറ്റ് ഇസ് വൈ സെഡ് ഇറ്റ്സ് വെരി ഡിഫിക്കൾട്ട് ടു ഡിറ്റർമിൻ എ കാനൺ. യു നോ ദാറ്റ് റോബർട്ട് ബേൺസ്, വൺ ഓഫ് യുവർ ഫേവറേറ്റ് പോയറ്റ്സ്, നമ്മളൊക്കെ കുട്ടിക്കാലത്ത് ആദ്യം കേട്ടു തുടങ്ങിയ കവിതയൊക്കെ ബേൺസിന്റെ കവിതയാണ്, മൈ ലവ് വേഴ്സ് ലൈക്ക് എ റെഡ് റെഡ് റോസ് എന്നൊക്കെ പറഞ്ഞു. ബട്ട് ബേൺസ് ഇസ് നോട്ട് ദെയർ ഇൻ ദി അമേരിക്കൻ സിലബസ്, ബിക്കോസ് ഹി വാസ് എ വുമനൈസ്ഡ്. You know that Burns had a number of affairs with very young women, and he was a father to so many people whom he even know. He didn't even know how many children he had. So because his personal life was a kind of it was almost like a Casanova, the syllabus makers, they decided, why should we have a writer whose life is full of licentiousness? Why should we have a person who is not having a what you call appropriate sexual behavior? So he's out of the syllabus. Just imagine, a writer has to be taken into account for being a writer, and here you have all his personal relationships brought into the syllabus. So he is not there in the American university syllabus any longer. Soon it will be happening to our Indian universities too. So that is my brief introduction to canon. And the second part I'll be talking about what is popular literature and how did it came into being, or what was the one thing that opened the doors for popular literature to arrive. നമ്മൾ ജോൺ ദ ബാപ്റ്റിസ്റ്റിനെ കുറിച്ച് പറയല്ലേ, അദ്ദേഹമാണ് ശരിക്കും ക്രൈസ്റ്റിന് വഴിയൊരുക്കി കൊടുത്തത്. അല്ല, ക്രൈസ്റ്റ് ഒരു സുപ്രഭാതി വന്നിട്ട് ഞാനാണ് നിങ്ങളുടെ ഇടയൻ എന്നൊക്കെ പറഞ്ഞു കഴിഞ്ഞാൽ വിശ്വസിക്കാൻ ബുദ്ധിമുട്ടായിരുന്നു. സോ ദർ വാസ് സംബഡി ഹു ആക്ച്വലി പേവ്ഡ് ദ വേ ഫോർ ഹിം ഓർ ഇൻട്രൊഡ്യൂസ്ഡ് ഹിം, ക്രൗൺഡ് ഹിം ടു ബി ദ കിങ് ഓഫ് ദി മാസസ്. ആൻഡ് so what actually made popular literature foray into the well established terrains of literature? So that is what we are going to see now. You know that literary theory has roots stretching back to Western aesthetics. So you have different people talked about culture, how it has got a redeeming effect on people and so on. There are so many definitions. See, one of the things that I have to tell you is that when introducing a concept like popular literature to a postgraduate student or somebody who has completed the post graduation is very different from talking to youngsters like you who have no idea about cultural studies. So I'll not be talking about cultural studies concepts like ideology, hegemony and so on, which are too very difficult, or not difficult, you're not introduced to it. So that is why. So I'm not going into that terrain. So I'll be talking about what culture is in a very conventional form. For instance, you have a person called Matthew Arnold. Arnold was the first one to actually make a difference between high culture and popular culture. He was not using the term popular culture. It is surprising to know that he never used popular culture, but he said, what is high culture? So everybody knew, if this is high culture, then there is something called low culture where they do not want to fall into. And he said, culture is always, and one of the reasons or one of the ways in which we can actually maintain culture or high culture, very refined culture, is by providing education. And the second is by through what you call cultivating a set of refined practices, which he called as high culture. Okay, so if you say that this person has got culture, he had some criteria for that, and anybody who does not stand up to that becomes part of popular culture. Whom he did not use the term popular culture, but it was considered to be part of this very unrefined culture. Now he has written all that in his very very famous book called Culture and Anarchy, which was published in 1869, saying that there is always something which is called the best, or the culture which he defined as the best that was said and done in the world, or thought in the world, best that was thought in the world. So he defined best for the British men, and because of that, he said by inculcating certain values which are not very natural. For instance, I always use this example, when you were kids, you know, നിങ്ങളിപ്പോ എൽ കെ ജി യു കെ ജി ക്ലാസ്സിലൊക്കെ പഠിക്കുമ്പോഴേക്കും നിങ്ങളുടെ അടുത്തിരിക്കുന്ന ആള് നിങ്ങൾ അടിച്ചു കഴിഞ്ഞാൽ നിങ്ങൾ തിരിച്ചടിക്കുമായിരുന്നു, അല്ലെങ്കിൽ നിങ്ങൾ ഓർത്തു വെച്ചിട്ട് ഇന്റർവെൽ സമയത്ത് പോയി അടിച്ചിട്ടുണ്ട്. അപ്പൊ നിങ്ങൾ ഇതെല്ലാം കഴിഞ്ഞിട്ട് വീട്ടിൽ വരുമ്പം പേരൻസ് പറയും, ഇപ്പോഴത്തെ പേരൻസിന്റെ കാര്യമൊക്കെ വളരെ കോമഡിയാണ്, പക്ഷെ എന്നാലും പേരൻസ് പൊതുവെ പറയുന്ന കാര്യമുണ്ട്, അത് ഒരു സംസ്കാരത്തിന് ചേർന്നതല്ല, അല്ലെങ്കിൽ അങ്ങനെയല്ല ചെയ്യേണ്ടത്. യു നോ, യു ഷുഡ് ആക്ച്വലി ആസ്ക് ദാറ്റ് അതർ പേഴ്സൺ ടു സേ സോറി ടു യു ആൻഡ് സേ ദിസ് ഇസ് നോട്ട് ദ വേ ഇറ്റ് ഈസ് ഡൺ ആൻഡ് സോ ഓൺ. ആൻഡ് യു നോ, സഡൻലി വാട്ട് ഹാപ്പൻ ടു is you become a very refined human being, but that is actually directly going against the very natural instinct of hitting back. So in one way it is nice, it is very good for your health also, but in another sense, you know, it's actually going against your instinctive culture. Okay, so that is why Matthew Arnold said this is something which is created, it is something not acquired, it is something that you have to inculcate, something which you will have to manipulate, something which you have to create within you. And though he was not very conscious that, you know, he was the first one to talk about popular literature in guise while he was talking about high culture, he was indirectly also hinting at popular culture. And he said it is distinctly opposite to the sweetness and light. You know, it's a very famous coinage of Matthew Arnold. He said sweetness and light associated with high culture, and everything downtrodden and what you call everything which is unsophisticated becomes the opposite to it, the other of sweetness and light. So this implied otherness is again a characteristic feature of popular literature. It is other. Now you know that when you move on to higher classes, you will study what is a binary opposition is. So you have day on one side and night on the other side, black on white on one side and black on the other. So whatever is there on the other side becomes the other, and whatever is there on the left side, it becomes the dominant ideology which is being propagated through ages. So this is the issue also. This is something which is very dangerous also. So when you see popular literature, naturally it becomes the other of canonical literature. And you know, you have people like Raymond Williams, you know, whom you will encounter later, said culture is one of the most difficult words in English literature. It is English language, because you cannot determine what is a culture, what defines a culture. But still, you find popular culture is always placed on the other side. You will learn more about it when you start reading cultural studies and how inclusive cultural studies is, because it included everything into its realm. It's an umbrella term which actually encompasses anthropology, advertising, films, television, dance, operas, pop music, comics, everything, graphic novels. Cultural studies, there is nothing that is outside cultural studies. So so once it was accepted, popular literature also got that kind of an acceptance. So what exactly is popular culture? You have been hearing this term for more than, I think, half an hour. What is it? Very simple definition. It is something that is favored by many people, not by a few, not by an elitist few, not by a committee of members, not by a class of people, but by many people, irrespective of any kind of differences. In other words, many believe that it is a residue. It's actually the leftover of high culture. You have high culture, which is considered to be classic, which is considered to be great, something to be proud of, and something which is considered to be local, you know, something which is considered to be going with the masses. Now, that is popular culture. And, you know, Bourdieu and others, you know, they speak about the taste, you know, how is a taste created in you? For instance, you know, you always have this concept, like, you know, you find a person, you are meeting a person for the first time, or imagine that in the classroom you are having a conversation, and you say that, you know, I like all the songs of say BTS, or I like all the Hindi songs, I like the popular songs, and the other person tells, oh, you like all this BTS and you know, Hindi songs, Tamil songs, the Dappanguthu songs and all. But I am a person who listens only to ghazals, classical music, and so on. Immediately, you actually place him in a category. Oh, he belongs to that high class. So what do you watch during weekends? And you say that, you know, I watch some movies on Netflix and the other person tells you, I watch Kathakali. When I get free time, I immediately open my YouTube and watch a Kathakali performance. Immediately you place him in a class. And this is the one class, this is something which determines what is popular culture and high culture. Okay, immediately there is a boundary is being drawn between you. And this is the very boundary that has to be broken to understand what is literature in a plurality of a sense. Okay, that is something that you have to understand. So it is not just, you know, the high forms of arts like, you know, classical dance forms and so on. It is not it, other forms of, you know, like very popular dance forms. അങ്ങനെയൊന്നും നമുക്ക് ഡിറ്റർമിൻ ചെയ്യാൻ പറ്റുന്ന ഒരു കാര്യമല്ല സാഹിത്യവും കല എന്നൊക്കെ പറയുന്നെങ്കിൽ പോലും ഇമ്മീഡിയറ്റ് ആയിട്ട് നമുക്ക് ഗസൽ കേൾക്കുന്ന ആള് അല്ലെങ്കിൽ ക്ലാസിക്കൽ സംഗീതം മാത്രം കേൾക്കുന്ന ആൾ എന്ന് പറഞ്ഞാൽ ഒരു ക്ലാസ് ഒരു ടേസ്റ്റ് രൂപപ്പെടുത്താൻ സാധിക്കുന്നു. ഇതിനെയാണ് നമ്മൾ പോപ്പുലർ കൾച്ചറും ഡോമിനൻ കൾച്ചർ എന്ന് പറയുന്ന അതുമായിട്ടുള്ള ഒരു വ്യത്യാസം. ഡോമിനൻ കൾച്ചർ എപ്പോഴും സോഫിസ്റ്റിക്കേറ്റഡ് ആവാൻ ശ്രമിക്കും. പോപ്പുലർ കൾച്ചർ എപ്പോഴും സാധാരണക്കാരുടെ കൂടെ അല്ലെ സാധാരണക്കാർക്ക് ഇഷ്ടപ്പെടുന്ന art forms in order nikkan samikum. That is a basic difference between this. Now you find that, you know, people like Harish Sivaramakrishnan, you know, everybody likes him, you like to listen to his songs and all, but there is a category of people who say, what is he exactly doing? Endanu cheyyunnathu idalla sangeetham. Or look at Arya Dayal is being criticized for some of the songs that is she is being singing, because, you know, they say this is not tradition, this is not what you are supposed to do. ഓർ വെൻ സൂരജ് സന്തോഷ് സേ ഡാലായാൽ തറ വേണ്ട കാര്യം ഉണ്ടോ എന്നാണ് ചോദിക്കുന്നത്. അല്ലെ പണ്ട് പറയുന്നതാണ് ആലായാൽ തറ വേണം, അടുത്തമ്പലം വേണം, നല്ല അടക്കമുള്ള പെൺകുട്ടി വേണം, ആൺകുട്ടികൾ ഇങ്ങനെ ഇരിക്കണം. നമ്മളിപ്പോ ടോക്സിക് മാസ്കുലിനിറ്റി എന്നൊക്കെ പറഞ്ഞ് നമ്മൾ പറയുന്ന കാര്യങ്ങളാണ് ഒരു കവിതയിലൂടെ വരുന്നത്. ഇപ്പൊ പുതിയ തലമുറ തിരിച്ചു ചോദിക്കുകയാണ്, ഇതൊക്കെ ആവശ്യമുണ്ടോ? ശരിക്കും പെണ്ണായാലും അങ്ങനെ വേണോ, അടക്കം വേണോ? അതൊക്കെ എവിടെ പറഞ്ഞിരിക്കുന്ന കാര്യമാണ് ഇതൊക്കെ. സോ ദാറ്റ് ഇസ് ഇറ്റ്. സോ ദ ഡോമിനന്റ് ഐഡിയോളജി ഈസ് ഓൾവേസ് ക്രിട്ടിസൈസ്ഡ് ഇൻ popular culture. Okay, so the second feature of popular culture is mass culture. Okay, nammal mass ennulla word ennu parayunnathu ശരിക്കും ഒരു മാസ് ആയിട്ടുള്ള വേർഡ് തന്നെയാണ്. നിങ്ങൾ തന്നെ പറയുന്ന ഒരു വേർഡാണ് അല്ലെ, നീ മാസ് ആണ്ടാ അല്ലെ നീ കൊലമാസ് ആണ്ടാന്നൊക്കെ. എനിക്ക് വലിയ ഇഷ്ടമുള്ള ഒരു പ്രയോഗമാണ് മാസ് എന്നുള്ളത്, ബിക്കോസ് ഇറ്റ് ആക്ച്വലി ഗോസ് വിത്ത് യു നോ ദ കൾച്ചറൽ സ്റ്റഡീസ്. ബിക്കോസ് യു നോ ഇറ്റ് ആക്ച്വലി ടെൽസ് ഇൻ ഹൈ കൾച്ചർ യു ഹാവ് ഇൻഡിവിജ്വൽസ് ആർ സ്റ്റാർസ്. ഓക്കെ, ശാസ്ത്രീയ സംഗീതം പാടുന്ന ഒരു മനുഷ്യൻ, ഒരു ഭാഗവതർ, ഒരു പണ്ഡിതൻ, ഇങ്ങനെയുള്ള കോൺസെപ്റ്റ് എന്നാണ്. യു ഹാവ് എ ഗ്രൂപ്പ് ഓഫ് പീപ്പിൾ, എ ഗ്രൂപ്പ് ഓഫ് ഇൻഡിവിജ്വൽസ്, എ കളക്റ്റീവ് ഓഫ് പീപ്പിൾസ്. ദേ ആർ ദ വൺസ് ഹു ആർ performing, or they are the ones who are enjoying the whole thing. So from individuality you have a collective form in popular culture, which is again a feature of popular culture. So it becomes a culture for the people, of the people. So that is again very, very different when you take into consideration the concept of high culture. Then I'll be talking about something like, you know, in the context of Kerala. നമ്മുടെ കേരളത്തിൽ തനതായിട്ടുള്ള പുള്ളുവൻ പാട്ട്, സർപ്പപ്പാട്ട്, നാഗപ്പാട്ട്, കൊയ്ത്ത് പാട്ട്, ഇങ്ങനെയൊക്കെ പറയുന്ന ആർട്ട് ഫോംസ് ഉണ്ടായിരുന്നു. ഇതിനെയൊന്നും ആർട്ട് ഫോംസ് എന്നൊന്നും ആരും വിളിച്ചിരുന്നില്ല, കാരണം ഇതൊക്കെ ഒരു തൊഴിലിടങ്ങളിലെ ആൾക്കാർ പാടുന്നതായതുകൊണ്ട് ഈവൻ തെയ്യം വാസ് ആക്ച്വലി കൺസിഡേർഡ് ഇൻ ദാറ്റ് സെൻസ്. ഇതിൻ്റെയൊക്കെ ഒരു പ്രശ്നം എന്ന് വെച്ച് കഴിഞ്ഞാൽ അന്നത്തെ ഡോമിനൻ്റ് ഐഡിയോളജിയിൽ ശാസ്ത്രീയമായിട്ടുള്ള പാട്ടുകൾ, മോഹിനിയാട്ടം അല്ലെങ്കിൽ കഥകളി, ഇതിനെയൊക്കെയാണ് ഇമ്പോർട്ടൻസ്. ഇതൊക്കെ ഒരു എന്താ പറയുന്ന ഒരു ലോ കൾച്ചറിന്റെ പാർട്ടായതുകൊണ്ട് ഇതിനെയെല്ലാം അങ്ങ് ഡിറൈഡ് ചെയ്തു. അതുകൊണ്ട് തന്നെ ഇതിനൊന്നും ഇതെല്ലാം ഓറൽ ട്രഡീഷനിൽ മാത്രം നിലനിന്നിരുന്ന കാര്യമാണ്. ബട്ട് വാട്ട് ഹാപ്പൻ ഡ്യൂറിംഗ് ദ 21st സെഞ്ച്വറി, വി ആർ കമ്പൈലിംഗ് ഇറ്റ്, വി ആർ മേക്കിംഗ് ഇറ്റ് കം ബാക്ക്. ആൻഡ് ദിസ് ഇസ് എക്സാക്ട്ലി വാട്ട് യു നോ ഗ്രാംഷി ടോക്സ് അബൌട്ട് വെൻ ഹി സ്പോക്ക് അബൌട്ട് ഹെജ്മണി. ഹെജ്മണി ആസ് വി നോ ഇസ് ആക്ച്വലി ഇറ്റ്സ് എ ട്രഡീഷൻ ഇമ്പോസ്ഡ് ഓൺ പീപ്പിൾ ബൈ ദ ഡോമിനന്റ് പാർട്ടി, യു നോ ഹു ആർ ഇസ് റൂളിംഗ്. So there is slight aitulla or psychological aitulla or invasion kudeyan. So they say that this is class and the other is mass. So class and mass is always contrasted in popular culture. Okay, so you know, it is an intellectual subordination also. When you say that, you know, I'll be singing, ippa adukku maari varuvaanu naadan paattukal ennu parnju kaniya bhayangara respectable aitulla kaaryamayittu varuvaanu allengil adinte pala forms varunnundu. But at one point of time they were always kept at the margins. They were not considered to be part of the dominant ideology. So that is why popular culture is also a site of resistance against the incorporation. അല്ലെ ഇതിലേക്ക് ഇൻകോർപ്പറേറ്റ് ചെയ്യാൻ വേണ്ടി ഡോമിനന്റ് ഐഡിയോളജി ഇതാണെന്ന് പറഞ്ഞ് നമ്മളെ പറഞ്ഞു. അല്ലെങ്കിൽ തന്നെ നമുക്ക് ഇപ്പൊ തന്നെ അറിയാം, നമ്മൾ കേരള ബ്രോഷർ എടുക്കുമ്പോൾ, കേരള ടൂറിസത്തിന്റെ ബ്രോഷർ എടുക്കുമ്പോൾ അതിന്റെ ഫ്രണ്ടിൽ ഒരു കഥകളി കാണും, ഒരു മോഹിനിയാട്ടം കാണും, മോഹിനിയാട്ടം കളിക്കുന്ന ഒരു ഇമേജ് കാണും. നമ്മളിൽ എത്ര പേർക്ക് കഥകളി കാണാനുള്ള ഭാഗ്യം ഉണ്ടായിട്ടുണ്ട്? അതായത് ഞാൻ പറയുന്ന യൂട്യൂബിലല്ല, അല്ലെ കനകക്കുന്നിലെ ഒരു പ്രത്യേക സമയത്തല്ല, എനിക്കൊരു കഥകളി കാണണം എന്ന് പറഞ്ഞു കഴിഞ്ഞാൽ നമുക്ക് പോയി കാണാനുള്ള ഒരു സ്പേസ് യഥാർത്ഥത്തിൽ ഇല്ല. കൂത്തമ്പലങ്ങളൊന്നും അത്ര പ്രോമിനന്റ് അല്ല. എങ്കിലും കേരളത്തിന്റെ ഒരു ബ്രോഷർ എടുക്കുമ്പോൾ, കേരളത്തിന്റെ ടൂറിസം ബ്രോഷറിൽ ആദ്യം വെക്കുന്ന പടം എപ്പോഴും മോഹിനിയാട്ടം ആയിരിക്കും, അല്ലെ കഥകളി ആയിരിക്കും. വൈ? ടു സേ ദാറ്റ് ദിസ് ഇസ് അവർ കൾച്ചർ. ഇൻഫാക്ട് ഇറ്റ് ഇസ് നോട്ട് അവർ കൾച്ചർ, ഇൻഫാക്ട് ഇറ്റ് ഇസ് ഓൾസോ അവർ കൾച്ചർ. ഓക്കെ, അപ്പോ നമ്മുടെ നാടൻ പാട്ടും കളമെഴുത്ത് പാട്ടും ഇങ്ങനെയുള്ള എല്ലാ ആർട്ട് ഫോംസും കൂടെ ചേർന്നാണ് കേരളം എന്ന് പറയുന്ന ഒരു സങ്കല്പം. പക്ഷെ അതിനെയെല്ലാം മാറ്റി നിർത്തി നമ്മള് കഥകളിയെ മാത്രം പ്രൊജക്ട് ചെയ്യുമ്പോൾ ഉണ്ടാവുന്ന ഡേഞ്ചേഴ്സ്, ദാറ്റ് ഇസ് വാട്ട് ഇസ് അണ്ടർസ്റ്റുഡ് ബൈ ദിസ്. ദെൻ അഗെയിൻ ഇൻ പോസ്റ്റ് മോഡേണിസം ഓൾസോ ഹാസ് എ കോൺട്രിബ്യൂട്ടറി എഫക്ട് ടു popular culture, because in postmodernism they say that, you know, there is no distinction between high art and low art, or high culture and low culture. Later on, you know, you even have concepts like grand narratives and meta narratives and so on. I'm not going to the details of that. So the breaking down of boundaries of high and low culture again is a feature of popular culture. So you cannot say this is high, this is good, and this is bad. Both are needed for the survival of what you call, or the longevity of the concept of literature. That is what is a very striking feature of popular culture. And you find that urbanization, industrialization, globalization, the advent of mass media, all these have changed the concept of looking at what is culture and what is high culture and low culture. And we have actually merged it together by saying that even when we have high culture, we need to have a popular culture which appeals to the masses. So that is again part and parcel of our system. So that will be the second part of my lecture. The third part I will be looking at, how does it work, or what are the manifestations of its work. ഇതൊക്കെ വർക്ക് ചെയ്യുന്നുണ്ട്, പോപ്പുലർ കൾച്ചർ ശരിക്കും വർക്ക് ചെയ്യുന്നുണ്ടോ നമുക്ക് എങ്ങനെ അറിയാൻ പറ്റും? ശരിക്കും അത് വർക്ക് ചെയ്യുന്നുണ്ടെന്ന് ഞാനിനി പറയുന്ന കാര്യങ്ങൾ കേൾക്കുമ്പോൾ നിങ്ങൾക്ക് ചിലപ്പം തനിയെ തോന്നാൻ സാധ്യതയുണ്ട്. സോ യു നോ ദാറ്റ് വെൻ ഇൻ 1970s, വെൻ പോപ്പുലർ കൾച്ചർ വാസ് ഇൻട്രൊഡ്യൂസ്ഡ് ഓർ ഇറ്റ് വാസ് കൺസിഡർഡ് ടു ബി എ പാർട്ട് ഓഫ് മെയിൻ ലിറ്ററേച്ചർ, സം ക്രിറ്റിക്സ് ഒപ്പോസ്. ദേ സെഡ് നോ നോ, ലെറ്റ് ഇറ്റ് ബി ദെയർ, let all these forms of art, let it be there, all these forms of literature, let it be there, all these graphic novels, comic strips, whatever, it be there, but you should never include it in the canon. It should never be taught in the universities or given the kind of importance that canonical texts receive. Always it should be sidelined. Now, but it cannot be, because we are people living in an era of new sensibility, and I'll tell you how it works, for the simple reasons that the poetics and politics of a work of art is something which is valuable for us. I'll tell you in simple terms. When you read something, you are not just looking at the language of the text or what the writer means by it or something like that. We are also looking at its political correctness, whether it is right to say that, whether it is appropriate to say that. That is something which all of us are very concerned these days, right? See, for example, I'll tell you, one of the things is that our reading habits have changed considerably. This is again one reason why popular literature is now in your syllabus. For instance, when in the past, people had the leisure of reading a textbook for many days. For instance, you have books like War and Peace, canonical text. I think it is one of those books with the maximum number of characters, many pages, many lines, you know, it's a bulky book, but people used to read that. But will a young boy or a girl of a 21st century read that book? I mean, it would be very nice if you read that for various reasons, but you know, people will actually look at it from a very economical point of view. What will I gain by reading just one book? Meantime, I can read at least 10 books or maybe 15 books, or maybe I can listen to a number of audios. I can listen to a number of podcasts. I can watch some movies on OTT platforms. I can go for a discussion. I can attend a webinar. So, you know, you have so many ways of gathering knowledge, where, or maybe for entertainment, you have other means of entertainment also. So what happens is that you cannot, your reading habits have changed. It is now determined by all these things that, you know, collectively comprise in the form of internet, your mobile phones. All these are distractions. So you cannot say War and Peace is prescribed, you must read that book. Sometimes you may not read, and you cannot penalize a student for that, though it will be very, very good if a student reads that. Or look at a novel like Tom Jones. You learn a lot of things, you not learn a lot of ideas from that. But will a student just sit in one place, keep there, and start reading a book and continue reading that forever? I don't think so. That is one of the reasons why we have books that should be so, I mean, they should be very crisp and concise and very economical for the readers. That is one of the reasons why our reading habits have changed. So the quantity of knowledge becomes very important. Etra maatram nam karyangal namak ariyanulladu etra vaichittund ennulla karyam വളരെ ഇമ്പോർട്ടൻ്റ് ആണ്. അല്ലാതെ ഞാൻ ഒരു ബുക്ക് വളരെ ഡീറ്റെയിൽ ആയിട്ട് വായിച്ചു എന്ന് പറയുന്നതിനെക്കാട്ടും എനിക്ക് ഇത്രയും 12 ബുക്സിൻ്റെ അകത്തുള്ള കാര്യങ്ങൾ അറിയാം എന്ന് പറയുന്നത് മഹത്തായി കാണുന്ന ഒരു കാലഘട്ടം കൂടെയാണ്. Therefore, our reading habits have changed. The second thing is very, very special, something which your generation should be proud of. Not mine, not even mine. Because you know that there are so many things which are, you're very sensitive to certain things. For instance, I'll give you an example. നമ്മുടെ മണിച്ചിത്രത്താഴില് ഭയങ്കര ഫേമസ് ആയിട്ടുള്ള ഒരു സീനാണ്. പപ്പുവിൻ്റെ ക്യാരക്ടറിന് മാനസികമായിട്ടുള്ള അസ്വാസ്ഥ്യമുണ്ട്. ഡോക്ടർ സണ്ണി എന്ന് പറയുന്ന മോഹൻലാൽ ഡോക്ടറാണ്. അപ്പൊ ഒരു മാനസിക വിദഗ്ധൻ എന്നൊക്കെയാണ് പറയുന്ന സണ്ണി കുട്ടനാണ് അല്ലെ, ഒരുപാട് പേപ്പേഴ്സ് ഒക്കെ എഴുതിയ മനുഷ്യനാണ്. അപ്പൊ ആ മനുഷ്യനോട് പറയാണ് എനിക്ക് സുഖമില്ല എന്ന് പറയുമ്പോ, യു മസ്റ്റ് ഹാവ് സീൻ, നമ്മളെല്ലാം തിയേറ്ററിൽ ഇരുന്ന് അല്ലെങ്കിൽ ടി വിയിൽ കണ്ട് ചിരിച്ച ഒരു സീനാണ്. പുള്ളി കളിയാക്കുകയാണ് ചെയ്യുന്നത്, വെള്ളത്തി ചവിട്ടരുത് എന്നിട്ട് എന്ന് പറയുന്നത്. നമ്മളെല്ലാം തിയേറ്ററിൽ ചിരിച്ചു. അന്നത്തെ കാലത്ത് ഏറ്റവും വലിയ തമാശയായിട്ട് ഇപ്പോഴും പൊയ്ക്കൊണ്ടിരിക്കുകയാണ്. ബട്ട് ജസ്റ്റ് യുനോ, ഇന്നത്തെ ഒരു 21st സെഞ്ചുറിയിലെ ഒരു കുട്ടി ചിലപ്പോൾ അത് കണ്ടാ ചിരിക്കണമെന്നില്ല. ബിക്കോസ് ഇമ്മീഡിയറ്റ്ലി ഹി വിൽ ആസ്ക് ദ ക്വസ്റ്റ്യൻ, ഹി ഈസ് എ ഡോക്ടർ, വാസ് ഹി സപ്പോസ് ടു സേ ദാറ്റ് ടു എ പേഴ്സൺ ഹു ഇസ് മെന്റലി സിക്ക്? ആൻഡ് വെൻ ഇറ്റ് ഇസ് ഡിപിക്റ്റഡ് ഇൻ ദ മൂവി, when it is depicted in a very popular movie by a popular actor, it gives the impression that mental illness is something to be laughed at. Or look at the way in which drinking is being valorized or eulogized in movies. It is celebrated in movies. Or even misogyny, slapping a woman. Now, kappadu nokka parayan cinema nippa irangunna endondana sensibility maariyadondana. Just imagine or 10-20 varsham munpana thappadu irangirunnengilo. People will laugh. What is there for the central character to leave her husband just because slapping, only one slap? But one slap determines the entire essence of a relationship is something that which we and, I mean, I and you will understand. Or maybe you will understand much better than me. That is basically because we live in an era of new sensibilities, in an era of political correctness. We, where, you know, a filmmaker is challenged to write things which will never offend any person. A religious minority offend cheyan padilla, sexual minorities ne hurt cheyan padilla, but transgenders ne kaliyaaki kondu pandu ishtam pole scenes undayirunnu. Can a filmmaker do that now? No, because they know that it is not the right thing to do. That is because there is an awakening of new sensibility, which is again part of the popular culture. It is again a boon of popular culture. So you find, you know, I have studied a novel called Heart of Darkness by Joseph Conrad, which has very explicit statements of racism. They call the other person nigger, black and all. But we studied that. But now, you know, when you study that, you are also studying that this is not the right way to address a person. Or when you read a novel by Ernest Hemingway, great novels, no doubt, but they are full of misogyny. It is about toxic masculinity and so on, benevolent sexism and so on. These are all new gen words, I know that. So this is again part and parcel of that. You start questioning it. That is again another feature why popular literature is included. Then, or, you know, I always think of a scene in the movie Kunyikunan, you know, where, you know, a person who is a dwarf in size, you know, they are being made fun of. What right has a filmmaker to make fun of these kind of, differences. I'll call it as only differences. It is not an imperfection, it's just a difference. So that is why a new sensibility is responsible for popular literature. Then also you have different literary genres coming up. For instance, you have something like the climate fiction is there. So you cannot say no to these kind of things, you know. So they are all accommodated into the realm of popular literature. Then also, then other thing is that when you have a popular literary work introduced into a syllabus, it actually gives a chance for you to have a direct interaction with the writer, because most of them are living writers, young writers. So suppose you read, say, Soya Factor, you know, you are reading and you just want to write to the writer, you can do that. Most of the writers are living. And that is, again, see, it doesn't mean that all the writers are living, because, you know, you have in your syllabus the tales from Grimm Brothers, Bob Dylan is there. Then, of course, you know, John Lennon. So I'm not saying that it's not a general statement, but you can connect with the authors. That's, again, a great thing that a literature student can think of. Something which, you know, our forefathers could not believe will happen, because, you know, they studied writers who are dead and gone. So that is it. So, and also, see, suppose you are coming to the first year syllabus, you are introduced to the first year syllabus. The first thing that you learn sometimes must be Romeo and Juliet. Maybe you don't just connect with Romeo and Juliet, but all of us will connect with the Twilight series. So you know Stephanie Meyer much better than Shakespeare. So it doesn't mean that Shakespeare should be replaced with Stephanie Meyer, but Stephanie Meyer should be the stepping stone to understand what Shakespeare is. So that is a reversal of ideas that has taken place when you introduce popular literature. It doesn't mean that, you know, you have to say no Shakespeare for us. Many universities have said no Shakespeare from today onwards, because, you know, he is outdated. You know that, you know, age cannot wither any tales of Shakespeare. So, you know, you cannot just throw him out. But it also doesn't mean that, you know, he is the one and only writer of all times. Suppose you write a poem and somebody tells, Kavideka kolam pashe eduthachan dathrayim poira. Ennu parna kanya, it doesn't hold any water. Okay, that is the difference. So that is the difference between popular literature and what you call as canonical literature. The other thing is that, you know, a student always reads children's literature. They always love reading that. Then you have young adult literature. And then you move to higher forms of literature. പക്ഷെ ഈ ഒരു കോൺസെപ്റ്റിനെ അഡ്രസ് ചെയ്യുന്നതല്ല നമ്മുടെ സിലബസ്. നിങ്ങൾ ചിൽഡ്രൻസ് ലിറ്ററേച്ചർ വായിച്ചുകൊണ്ടിരുന്നിട്ട് പെട്ടെന്ന് വരുമ്പോഴേക്കും യു ആർ, ഓർ ജസ്റ്റ് ഇമാജിൻ, പ്ലസ് ടു കഴിഞ്ഞിട്ട് വരുമ്പോൾ ഉടനെ നിങ്ങൾ വായിക്കുന്നത് വെരി സീരിയസ് സ്റ്റഫ്, വെരി കോംപ്ലിക്കേറ്റഡ് സ്റ്റഫ്. മേ ബി ദ സ്റ്റുഡൻറ്റ് വിൽ ബി ജസ്റ്റ് ഷോക്ഡ് ഓർ നോ ഡിസ്മേഡ്, യു ഐ ഹാവ് ടു സ്റ്റഡി ഓൾ ദിസ്. സോ ദാറ്റ് വിൽ ഓൾസോ ബി ദാറ്റ് ഗ്യാപ്പ് വിൽ ഓൾസോ ബി ബ്രിഡ്ജ്ഡ് വെൻ യു ഹാവ് പോപ്പുലർ ലിറ്ററേച്ചർ, ബിക്കോസ് യു ക്യാൻ ജസ്റ്റ് ഗ്ലൈഡ് ഇൻ ടു ഇറ്റ് ബിക്കോസ് ഇറ്റ് ഈസ് ജസ്റ്റ് യങ് അഡൾട്ട് ഫിക്ഷൻ. So, you know, imagine you have to study Harry Potter series. You've already studied some of them or already read that as a child. And just imagine the joy of a child who has to study Harry Potter as a in their syllabus. So that is the that's also there. So, you know, it makes a bridging gap between serious literature and children's literature. So it actually connects them. So there is something that which connects a child to Harry Potter, which may not be the same with something else from another bygone era. So that is it. So then, you know, you must have also studied or heard things like, you know, when you say that, you know, I'm studying Julius Caesar. Imagine your grandmother comes from the other room and tells, I also studied Julius Caesar. Then suddenly the child will think, what am I doing? Am I studying the same stuff that my grandma also studied? Am I that outdated? So, you know, the child will never like to study these kind of things. കുറച്ചു കാലം കഴിയുമ്പോൾ മനസ്സിലാവും ജൂലിയസ് സീസർ എല്ലാ കാലത്തും വായിക്കേണ്ട ഒരു പ്ലേ ആണെന്ന്. പക്ഷെ മേ ബി അറ്റ് എ വെരി ബിഗിനിങ് സ്റ്റേജ് ദ ചൈൽഡ് മേ നോട്ട് റിലേറ്റ് ടു ദാറ്റ്. സോ ദാറ്റ് ഇസ് വൈ ടെക്സ്റ്റ് വിച്ച് ആർ സിലക്റ്റഡ്. നൗ ദിസ് ഇസ് അഗെയിൻ എ വെരി ക്രൂഷ്യൽ ഫാക്ടർ. ഹു സിലക്ട്സ് ഓൾ ദീസ് തിങ്സ് ഫോർ യു? സോ വാട്ട് എവർ ഇസ് ദ സെൻസിബിലിറ്റി ഓഫ് ദ പീപ്പിൾ ഹു ആർ സിലക്ടിംഗ്, ദാറ്റ് വിൽ ബി റിഫ്ലെക്റ്റഡ് ഇൻ യുവർ സിലബസ്. ഫോർ ഇൻസ്റ്റൻസ് എൻവയോൺമെന്റലിസം എന്ന് പറയുമ്പോൾ ഇപ്പോഴും ചിലർക്ക് തോറോ ഉണ്ട് വോൾഡനിൽ പോയി താമസിച്ചതൊക്കെയാണ്. സോ ദേ ഹാവ് നോട്ട് ഗ്രോൺ ഫ്രം ദയർ. സോ ദാറ്റ് ബിക്കംസ് എ വെരി കോംപ്ലിക്കേറ്റഡ് തിങ്സ്. യു ഹാവ് ടു ഗ്രോ, യു ഹാവ് ടു റീഡ്, യു ഹാവ് ടു അണ്ടർസ്റ്റാൻഡ് വാട്ട് ഇസ് എ ന്യൂ സെൻസിബിലിറ്റി. യു ഹാവ് ടു റീഡ് ടെക്സ്റ്റ് ബുക്സ് വിച്ച് ആർ ഓർ ബുക്സ് വിച്ച് ആർ കണക്റ്റഡ് ടു ക്ലൈമറ്റ് ചേഞ്ച് അബൌട്ട് ആന്ത്രോപോസീൻ. ഓൺലി ദെൻ യു ക്യാൻ ഹാവ് എ കോംപ്രിഹെൻ comprehensive picture of what is what are the things that goes into popular literature and what are the things that youngsters read. And being a teacher, I think Shabari and others will be doing that every time because he himself is a very young teacher. You have to just go and search and you have to go and probe what are the things that youngsters like to read. And you have to just make it sure that this is their sensibility and not criticize them and say, suppose somebody tells, you know, I like to read Amish Tripathi. And you say that, you know, how dare you read that, or Chetan Bhagat. You take up the textbook and throw it away and say, go and read Henry Fielding. Now, you cannot say that because we have to understand these are the kind of things that attracts the modern generation, and you have to comply with that. You have to make a balance with that. You have to make an agreement with that and slowly introduce them to the world of good literature, good books. Not that, you know, you have to criticize these are not popular books, you should throw it away. There should be a midway path. And this is something that teachers have to be very consciously aware of. Not saying that, you know, the new generation is a bad generation because avaru Chetan Bhagat mathrame vaikku. That is not the way to approach reading in the era of popular literature. So just imagine, you know, some you look at the kind of things that you have to study. You have fairy tales to study. Just imagine, I'll be very thrilled to know that, you know, you have a fairy tale like Juniper Tree to study. Though it is a very bleak story, still you have a fairy tale. Then you have detective fiction. Arthur Conan Doyle is there for you. Then movies are there. Of course, John Lennon is there. Lewis Carroll, the poem. Then, of course, Tintin is there. Soon there will be Asterix in your syllabus. Soon there will be Game of Thrones in your syllabus. So a series is there in your syllabus. Just imagine something that which you have watched again and again, or maybe watched all of a sudden, I mean, in a set. It is there for you to study. So the thrill of the child who has to go through all this as a student will be is something that a syllabus maker has to understand, or a teacher has to understand. So sometimes we know that, you know, years back, who would have thought that, you know, comics will be there in the syllabus, but now it is there. Slowly, you know, it made inroads into the syllabus slowly and steadily. You know, you have graphic novels being there, and slowly it moved to comics. So that is it. So, and it's a bit challenging because you have to really hunt for new resources. You have to allada pandathe note vechittu spark notes vechittu padipikkan pattuna karyangalalla ee PLT il ullathu. It is something that demands the creativity of the person who is teaching also. So it is not something that you can grade savory ennum adinokke eduthittu idana summary ennu namukku parannu kodukkan pattuna oru karyamalla PLT. It is something that demands a lot of pressure on the teacher to introduce these things. That's one of the reasons why it is a bit challenging for the teacher and not for the students. How to make it interesting for them? How can I teach Tintin in a very interesting manner to the students? It is again a challenge to the teacher. So that is it. Now I'll just wind it up with my last part of my presentation with the characteristics of popular literature. One is it's very vivid. You can see that whether it is in fiction or movie or whatever, it is very vivid. It has a very racy plot. Kanam pudhi generation, they want speed. Speed is something which is a characteristic feature of new gen. Now they want to have, they have to enjoy so many things. They cannot just stuck up in one room and read one novel for 5 days and say that, you know, I have finished one novel. No, they are doing multiple things. Remember one thing, the present generation is an awesome generation. They are just awesome. Okay, they're wonderful. They do multiple things. They read so many things. They are so well informed. They are tech savvy. They know how to operate everything. They know. See, even this webinar is made possible because of the new awakened sensibility of the youth. Okay, not the older generation like us. You know, we have to struggle with all that. But for you, it is just a click of a system. That is why, you know. So it just goes with the young generation. So it's very racy, it is very exciting. So these kind of plots go into it. Or, you know, sensory images, they want to, that is why graphic novels sell, because, you know, you have the images are so captivating. So it is there. Then engaging characters, for instance, you know, pandu kalathe novelukalile oru character inde shoyude oka playile oru character samsarikkunnathu oru 3 page kaanu. ഇത് ഡ്രാമയിലാണെങ്കിലും കേട്ടോണ്ടിരിക്കാൻ അന്നത്തെ ആൾക്കാർക്ക് പറ്റുമായിരുന്നു. പക്ഷെ ഇന്ന് നിങ്ങളുടെ ഒരു സുഹൃത്ത് അരമണിക്കൂർ നിന്ന് സംസാരിക്കുകയാണ് അല്ലെങ്കിൽ 10 മിനിറ്റ് നിന്ന് ഒരു കാര്യം സംസാരിക്കുകയാണെങ്കിൽ മേ ബി യു ഡോ യു ഗെറ്റ് ബോർഡ് ഓഫ് ഇറ്റ്. യു വാണ്ട് ഡയലോഗ്സ് വിച്ച് ആർ ഷോർട്ടർ, ക്രിസ്പർ ആൻഡ് യു നോ വെരി എന്റർടൈനിങ് സോ ദാറ്റ് ഇസ് വൈ ഇൻ ഗ്രാഫിക് നോവൽസ് ആൻഡ് ഇൻ ദ ന്യൂ ജെൻ നോവൽസ് ആസ് യു കോൾ ഇൻ പോപ്പുലർ ലിറ്ററേച്ചർ യു ഫൈൻഡ് ഡയലോഗ്സ് ആർ വെരി എന്റർടൈനിങ് ആൻഡ് ചാർമിങ് They're very crisp and very entertaining. That is it. Then, and also less dialogues, basically. People don't like people who talk very much. That's one of the reasons why teachers are not very popular with children, okay? Because they talk all the time and they will never listen to the students. Even when they say this is a dialogue, most of it is a monologue, okay? So that is why books which are, which has very less dialogues and more engaging plot structure, then no abstract problems. Like, you know, for instance, patriotism is the main theme of this book, or, you know, love is the main theme. It won't sell because they're very too abstract. They want things which are very specific, very concrete. Something happens and, you know, and so on, adventure and so on. Popular literature is all about that. Just look at your syllabus and you'll get a better idea of that. Then no idealism. They don't speak about, you know, this is how things are. Moral stories. You know, people hate moral stories. Youngsters hate that. I think in every generation, people used to hate moral stories, you know, because the problem with moral stories is that moral stories slightly inculcate in them values which you know, finally becomes dangerous for them. For instance, be always a good child. And I mean, of course, you have to be good. You have to be kind. You have to be generous, but not at the expense of destroying your life. So the modern generation of children know that, you know, these kind of stories work only in ethics classes or moral science classes and so on. We are all being victims of that, you know, be very nice to people and so on. Sometimes it doesn't work that way. Sometimes you'll have to make your mark right. When an elder is making a very bad remark against or very sneering remark at a fellow being based on his caste or color or creed, and you say that, you know, we should not be abusing an elder or we should not be talking back to an elder, you are making a mistake. In fact, you should actually step in and say, hey man, you are so old, why can't you actually understand that, you know, this is not the right way to talk to another human being? Because we live in an age where differences do not matter. It is not an age where we are celebrating all kinds of differences. So this is why, you know, moral stories don't work with youngsters. So don't try to preach them also. They won't listen, okay? Then the language should be very simple. Long, complicated languages, flowery languages, bombastic expressions, it doesn't hold water with the youngsters. They want something which is very simple, very lucid kind of prose. So these are things that popular literature always satisfies. So again, one of the reasons why traditional teachers of English literature, they have this aversion to these texts, because, you know, their language gets lost. But that is again a concern. Of course, I'm also concerned with that, you know, what will happen to the grammar of the students? What will happen to the sentence structure of the students? Of course, these are all concerned. I'm also concerned about that. But I believe that our generation is awesome. So they'll manage somehow. They will make a balance between what is a good literature and what is, you know, not bad literature, maybe inferior literature. That's it. Then what is the age group? All age groups can read popular literature. Youngster can read, and a senior citizen can also enjoy these books. And these books are instant, provide instant gratification, okay? Very small and, you know, concise. Therefore, it is very easy for them to read. Then it also allows them escape reading. You have a problem and you read it and your problem escapes, or something like that. Imagine that, you know, you have a problem and you start reading Thomas Hardy's textbook full of pessimism. Not even a grain of optimism in any of the novels. You will find that, you know, your life is doomed, and you know, you might feel depressed. So that is why, you know, escape. It offers a escape reading. Then also leisured reading. No complications involved. Nothing. Nobody is going to penalize you for not reading well. Therefore, you know, they like that. And some of the categories of popular literature include romance. Romance is an eternal favorite. Okay. Then mystery. Again, then fantasy, Then you know you have science fiction. See, many believe that, you know, students and youngsters, they don't like period dramas and so on, but you know, one of the I have noticed that, you know, it's just not true, because one of the most popular series in Netflix was Peaky Blinders, which is actually set in a in a different era altogether, and they enjoyed it, and even the dialogues, you know, sparkling dialogues, but still it is from a bygone era, but students liked it, youngsters liked it. So that is it: fantasy, science fiction, thrillers and horrors. Whether it is a movie or a book, they like to read thrillers and horror. Then young adult fiction, as I told you, like Harry Potter and other works. Then children's literature, of course, and inspirational books, okay, self-help books, how to be and so on. Those, even people read all that. This is one of the reasons why even when Chetan Bhagat was introduced in the Delhi University syllabus, some you know, Chetan Bhagat said, "I was honored," but I think he was the only person who said he was honored. All the others said, "Why is he in the syllabus? What is he doing in the syllabus? Why is 5 points someone in the syllabus?" That's because, you know, it's again a very tricky path. You can't say that has to be, you cannot idealize a popular literary work, and at the same time you cannot condemn it. Condemning it actually leads to dangers. So whenever there is only one story, whenever there is only one dominant voice, the other voices will be silenced. That's a universally accepted fact. So you should not be falling prey to that. So when popular literature is being introduced, it doesn't mean that that is the only form of literature that you should be pursuing. It only means this is also there. Let us have a look at that also. That is what is it all about. And the 21st century is actually about new sensibilities, new evaluation standards, new concepts being introduced and so on. And the mass media, the power of the mass media, the power of Facebook, all those OTT platforms, all these things will be reflected in literature. You know that literature is a slice of life, as you know, as critics say. So you cannot say that, you know, we'll be living in a bygone era of castles and dungeons and other things. That era is gone. It doesn't mean that we have to throw it away. We have to read them. We have to understand them. We have to go back to them. We have to feel nostalgic about them. But at the same time, accommodating everything into the realm of literature is actually a must in an age of multimedia. So that's one of the reasons why popular literature is being introduced into your syllabus. In fact, you're very lucky that you are studying that alongside Shakespeare. So Shakespeare meeting Bob Dylan may not be a reality in the real life, but in the literary world, they should meet and they should have a conversation and maybe exchange one or two ideas. That is all about PLT. And I wish all of you a wonderful year studying all this, reading all this, watching movies, talking to your teachers, fighting with your teachers. You question them, okay? You make their life miserable. Only then you will truly understand the real significance of what it is to be a literature student. It is, I think, the greatest blessing in the world. You speak about blessings, right? You speak about divine showers of blessings. One of the greatest blessings is to be a literature student, because a literature student is not just a student, but a lovely human being, because you know what is, what is the best way in which you can live in this world. You are the only people, perhaps, or we are the only people who knows how to make a living out of our dreams, our fantasies, and so on. So you're very lucky. So make use of that luck. Read abundantly. Read voraciously. Read everything. Watch all kinds of movies. Watch all kinds of, things that you can think of. And talk to your teachers about it. Write short notes about it. And make your life as a literature student very, very enjoyable. So happy reading, happy studying, and happy exam writing also. So wish you all the best. Let me also thank you for the patience that you have showed in listening to me. Thank you. It was a very nice morning for me. I hope it was the same for you too. Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much. Now it's time for a small Q&A session. So let's go ahead and take some time for the discussion. Students, you may raise your questions now.
Good noon, Kaikishi, ma'am.
Hello. Yes. Your name is Suman?
I'm Suman. I'm a student from English department. So the question I would like to ask is, since the paper, Popular Literature and Culture, deals with children's fiction like Tintin and Harry Potter, will it deviate students?
What is it?
Deals with children's fiction like Tintin and Harry Potter. Will it deviate students from the mainstream literature? Or the literary canon?
No. That is what I told you. See, when it is there in the syllabus, it does not mean that, you know, the student will think that, you know, this is something that has to be studied, or this is something that has to be studied with respect or something like that. But instead, you know, they'll have a balance of ideas. I'll always believe that when you read all this or when you study all this, naturally it becomes a window to learn what lies beyond. So they actually go to more textbooks and, you know, more ideas. So it will not limit them. So just because, you know, you have Harry Potter in the syllabus does not mean that the student is going to be limited by that. In fact, it opens up new vistas of knowledge for them. In fact, it actually becomes a gateway for them to actually just explore what lies beyond this. Because this is just a fragment taken from literature. It is only a part of maybe fantasy fiction. So you're just introduced to a part. So, you know, in the syllabus is not just about Harry Potter. See, you're not just studying Harry Potter in BA English syllabus. It is just part of it. So it does not mean that, you know, just because Harry Potter is there, you will not read Shakespeare or Milton or Johnson or other people. It just means that, you know, you are introduced to that also. So popular literature doesn't mean that you are limiting yourself to popular literature, but in fact, you are very lucky in that sense, because you can know or you are exposed to canonical literature and popular literature in the same semester. That, I think, is the greatest benefit of the syllabus being introduced. Because for us, you know, it was always canon. When we were students, we studied only canon. There was nothing outside the canon. Like Derrida will say, you know, there's nothing outside the text. But you are very lucky because you learned the canon and popular literature, which I think is a very balanced kind of a thing to do. So I don't believe that, you know, just because one thing is there in the syllabus, students will start feeling that, you know, this is this is good and this is bad. No, students are very sensible, you know, though we teachers sometimes, you know, underestimate them. They're very sensible in that sense. You know, you come to university college, you know, and the kind of discussions I have with my students, they are exemplary, because they ask me all kinds of questions from classical literature, theory and so on. They do not limit themselves to just, you know, Harry Potter or some mythical stories. So I have immense faith in our students. So I don't think that, you know, they will deviate from canonical literature. In fact, they will become well-balanced individuals, because they know what is canon and they know what is popular literature also. I hope I have answered your question, Suman.
Yes, ma'am, it's clear. Thank you.
Good afternoon, ma'am.
Good afternoon.
I'm Shravya from SS English.
Okay.
And I would like to ask you, how can we comprehend the relevance of Tintin in Tibet or Harry Potter or even the Zoya factor as an academic discourse?
What is it, Shreya? Can you please explain it once more?
Ma'am, how can we comprehend the relevance of the Tintin in Tibet or Harry Potter or even the Zoya factor, which are included in the syllabus as an academic discourse?
I think that's a very lovely question, because books that you have enjoyed reading outside your syllabi, okay, something that, you know, you have read leisurely as means of an escaped reading, as I said, suddenly it is part of your syllabus and you don't know what to do with it. The same thing happened to us when some of the novels which we used to enjoy made its way to the syllabus. So they always say, you know, like for instance, and I always think of my teacher's book, you know, How's That Butterfingers by Karen Misae, was one of my favorite books, and suddenly it made its way into the syllabus. So finally, in the final semester, the paper creative writing, it is being prescribed. So suddenly you have to look at this book from a very clinical perspective. You have to dissect the characters. What is the nature of this person? How is this done? What exactly happens in the novel? What are the kind of observations made by these things and so on? And analyze the novel as a cricket novel and so on. So it becomes a very clinical, sometimes mechanical enterprise because we are not used to that. Just imagine you watch a movie and you like that movie, and somebody in the exam hall questions you about that movie. Maybe you don't have anything to say because you did not approach that text or a movie with an academic perspective. That is again a problematic thing. But one of the ways in which you can tackle this is by when you are reading it for the first time, maybe Tintin in Tibet, you read it for leisure. You just enjoy it and read. You just sit back and relax, take a cup of coffee and read it. The second reading can be a more critical reading so that, you know, your leisure of enjoying a text as a literary text or maybe, you categorize it under the extensive reading textbooks, you know. Extensive reading textbooks are textbooks that you read outside your syllabus. So you can just read it for pleasure in the first one and read it very critically the second time so that this problem is solved, because you know you want to enjoy a text only when you can enjoy a text only when it is not prescribed. That is something which I personally believe. So you have to read Tintin in Tibet for leisure, and then perhaps as a text where, you know, you have to search for hidden meanings, vocabulary, or what exactly happens to Tintin when he goes to Tibet. What are the what are the conversations that he has with Captain Haddock, or how is Snowy a very important character in the series, and so on. So, and reading Tintin in Tibet does not restrict you to reading one Tintin alone. You have to read multiple Tintins. So one of the things about a syllabus is that a syllabus is not, see, nammal eppozhum parayunnathaanu portions cover cheyya nu parayunnathu. It's a very complicated usage. In fact, a very horrifying usage. Cover it. In fact, you should unravel the syllabus. So if Shakespeare's Hamlet is prescribed for you, you study Hamlet, but you read Othello, you read King Lear, you read Julius Caesar. So when Tintin in Tibet is prescribed for you, you study that in detail, but you read Tintin and the Golden Crab or Tintin and the Seven Crystal Balls. You read it for pleasure. So that is the... That's the kind of difference that you can make. You know, not just Tintin, you even have a book like, you know, Soya Factor, which is made into a popular movie. So you can make it very engaging. That is what I say. So don't approach it like, you know, oh, a book that I love to read is now part of the syllabus. Now I'll have to study that. Now I'll have to write it for the exam. Don't approach it like that. Approach it with in a very fun way. You make notes for yourself. You jot down everything that you find very interesting about it. And maybe you can enjoy the book in the same way that you enjoyed it for reading. I mean, for a leisurely reading. So both becomes very enjoyable. So I think whenever you are reading something for leisure, you are not bothered about anything else. You're not bothered about the critical interpretations. You're not bothered about theories, feminist reading, structuralist reading, nothing. You are an innocent reader when you read it for pleasure. But don't be an innocent reader. That is what I say. Whenever you are reading something, be a very critical reader also. Maybe that can happen in the later stage of reading. That is the only thing that I can say. Because, you know, just like Sravya, we are also new to the syllabus. We also don't know how to teach these things in the class. Because how can you make it very enjoyable? It's again a very problematic kind of a thing. Because Tintin asterisks okka njan kuttikalathu ella stories um vaichathaanu. അത് പഠിപ്പിക്കേണ്ടി വരുന്ന വെച്ചുകഴിഞ്ഞാൽ ഈവൻ ദാറ്റ് ഇസ് ഷോക്കിംഗ് ഫോർ മീ ഓൾസോ നോട്ട് ഷോക്കിംഗ് സ്ലൈറ്റ്ലി ഇറ്റ്സ് ഓൾസോ ഇൻട്രസ്റ്റിംഗ് ബട്ട് അറ്റ് ദ സെയിം ടൈം സ്ലൈറ്റ്ലി അൺബിലീവബിൾ ഐ വിൽ യൂസ് ദാറ്റ് വേർഡ് ഐ കാൻ സ്റ്റിൽ ബിലീവ് ദാറ്റ് ഐ ഹാവ് ടു ടീച്ച് Tintin ടു എ ഗ്രൂപ്പ് ഓഫ് സ്റ്റുഡൻസ് ഇറ്റ്സ് എ വെരി ചാലഞ്ചിങ് കൈൻഡ് ഓഫ് എ തിങ് ബട്ട് വെരി എന്റർടൈനിങ് വെരി ഇൻട്രസ്റ്റിംഗ് Yeah, approach it that way, okay? Don't take it in a very serious manner. And I hope you have answered your question, Shravya.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you.
Hi, ma'am. Good afternoon.
Hello,
my name is Nohin Shreyanbino.
Okay.
Ma'am, I belong to SSB English Literature.
Okay.
Ma'am, the question that I would like to ask you is that, ma'am, how could we appreciate Harry Potter and its version of world when we have an entirely different and unchangeable world?
Okay. Now, this is something which pertains to every novel which is grouped under what you call fantasy fiction. Fantasy does not believe in what you call the real world. But, you know, even in Harry Potter, you find certain elements which can be considered to be slightly complying with the, you know, the real world. You remember, I don't remember which is that Harry Potter, I think Goblet of Fire, where, you know, Harry Potter goes and tells, you know, I think somebody is spying on our room because, you know, there is a bug in our, we are being bugged and so on. And somebody comes and tells, no, there is no, we don't follow these kind of rules, you know, we don't trap your conversations like that. You know, there are, so, you know, you have certain times when reality is being brought into a very, very fictional world, or what you call a fantastical world. Just like, you know, you have to study Alice in Wonderland. Now, who will believe that, you know, a child will actually fall into a rabbit hole and experience all kinds of adventures there and come back from there? You know, it's improbable. But still, it is a metaphor. It's an allegorical, what you call, a statement that, you know, these things are, what you call, a cross-section of maybe a slice from the adult world. So Alice falls into the adult world and comes back. So, you know, so a child, when he's reading all this, when he's reading Harry Potter, they know that the magical wand is not a reality. Wingardium Leviosa will never make a feather rise up. You know, we know all that. But still, we enjoy it for the, perhaps for the kind of setting, perhaps for the magical surroundings, because literature is all about an escape into a world of fantasy. It is all about making you travel, move to different places, meet different kind of people, go to different nations, understand different sensibilities, understand different emotions. That is why, you know, you cry and when you read about somebody who has died in a war, even though you have never seen a war in your lifetime. So what makes you feel sorry for that person? What makes you shed tears for a person who is on a hunger strike? What makes you have tears for the farmers who are bleeding on the streets of Delhi? What is that? What that sensibility is called, the literary sensibility. The pain to understand the pain of somebody else. You call it as empathy. And that is the greatest power of literature. So I don't think that just by reading a novel which is magical in nature, the student will go back to have very, you know, feudal ideas about life, or, you know, maybe they have old world ideas and so on. I believe that, you know, it expands their horizon in that level also. There are so many books that takes you to magical worlds, not just Harry Potter. You have Peter Pan, where the boy does not grow up. Does that mean that, you know, we still believe in those kind of stories? There are so many stories which are improbable in literature. It doesn't make a person very regressive. In fact, it opens up to their mind to new vistas of imagination, basically imagination. So that willing suspension of disbelief is the charm of literature. So I don't think that just because Harry Potter is prescribed for you, your worldview will become so outdated. Perhaps it will make you a better reader. Yes. I don't know.
Thank you, ma'am. Thanks so much.
Thank you.
Hello, ma'am.
Hello.
My question is, how can we tackle the mode of representation in Harry Potter, which is primarily about white British people? How can we feel connected with the magic that is presented in it?
Again, you know, I think that is basically, you know, overlaps a question put forward by the Bibin, I think. You know, magic is not something which is real, as we all know. Magic is something, you know, you have seen a movie like Prestige, you know, where they say it tells you how magic is very, very it's deceiving. It is a disillusionment that you feel after watching a magic show, because the moment you realize what is the trick, you know, the charm is gone. So magic is not about reality. It is not about witches and, you know, flying saucers, but it is about a concept of how our mind travels. So when you have a novel which actually talks about you know, magical happenings, it is a kind of a dream that all of us have shared at one point of time. As a child, we have always been intrigued by magic, right? We are so surprised to find certain things which, you know, as a grown-up, some books that you loved as a child, some stories that you have loved as a child are things that you don't enjoy as an adult. And that is the, what do you call that, the pitfalls of growing up. So that is one of the dangers of growing up also. As a child, you have enjoyed so many things innocently. You have laughed and, you know, you have done all kinds of crazy things. But once you grow up, the magic also just moves away. Like Wordsworth talks about in on the Intimations of Immortality, you know, he tells, as a child, we are very closer to nature. But as we proceed, we become more complicated. We start looking at the rationality of things, and in one way it's very nice, but at the same time it takes away the magic in you. So you know, Harry Potter actually tells you or brings a fictional the magical world of Hogwarts, and also the person, you know, who is reading it enables them to think of overcoming their limitations. Okay. As human beings, we all have limitations. All of us have limitations. And magic is the one way in which we can overcome these limitations. Okay. So all of us have this beautiful image of ourselves flying, a beautiful image of we doing all kinds of things. See, as a child, I was very, very intrigued of, you know, I loved chocolates and ice creams. So I used to think that, you know, sometimes when I was in the classroom, listening to boring lectures in the mathematics class, I used to think, if I had the magical power, I could have an ice cream in my hand.
Hello, madam. Am I audible? I think there is some problem in the audio. We cannot. Hello, madam. Madam, can you hear me? Hello.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, madam. Yeah, I think there was a brief interruption in the network. You can continue, ma'am. You can continue.
Yeah, so that is it. So, okay. So what I was telling was that just because, you know, the magical world that is presented in Harry Potter is not real, but at the same time, it is not something that takes you away from the realities. Okay. So who will not like to have a friend like, you know, or a girlfriend like Hermione? So that is it. So just look it from that perspective. So it's not limiting yourself. In fact, it expands your knowledge. So, of course, you know, there are disagreements. You know, many academicians are opposed to that. Many people who believe that, you know, it shouldn't be there in the syllabus. Again, opinions differ, okay? So I'm not an academician in that sense. I'm not a policymaker. So I don't know whether it is the right thing to do. But I believe that, you know, whatever forms of literature enriches you. That's a general consensus that I think readers always reach. Okay, whatever you read, it enriches your soul. So there's nothing wrong in having Harry Potter in your syllabus.
Thank you.
Good afternoon, ma'am.
Good afternoon, Afsana Fazal.
Yes, ma'am. I'm Afsana, final year student from the English department.
Okay.
So, my question is somewhat an extension to what Suman and Shravya said. Instead of being introduced to Shakespeare or Milton, this paper introduces us to works like you said, the Charlie and the Chocolate Factory,
yeah,
Zoya Factor, or Game of Thrones in the future, etc. So, So how can we justify the gulf between these canonic literature and popular literature?
In fact, it is not aimed at gulfing any bridge between canonical and popular literature, because this is just a paper. If you look at the kind of things that, you know, a student of first year BA is studying, he is not just studying popular literature alone. He has another paper where he's introduced to poetry. He studies different forms of poetry. He studies what is an ode, what is a ballad, what is a elegy, epic, and he's introduced to a poem like, Annabel Lee by Edgar Allan Poe. He's also introduced to a haiku poem by Basho. So that is again there. So different kinds. I'm just giving you an example. There are different papers. There are different papers where, you know, the student gets a comprehensive idea of what literature is all about. It is not that he's studying only popular literature. See, we are concerned about popular literature because it made in its inroads into the syllabus only recently. We never had to teach popular literature as a discipline. Because when we are teaching something, I'll tell you a brief example. Maybe 10 years back, if a teacher goes to a class and tells, you must watch a movie, it was considered to be blasphemous. Imagine I come to a class and say, you must go for the film festival, IFFK. 10 years back, it was considered to be an act of what you call, it was considered to be something which cannot be imagined, because watching a movie was primarily for entertainment at that time. But now it is not. Movies are part of your syllabus. You have to watch a movie. You have to have a Netflix account or an Amazon account in your mobile. It is not something that you do for entertainment. You have to be alert about it. You have to watch reviews. You have to, because you have a movie writing as part of your syllabus. You have a script writing as part of your syllabus. You have a critical appreciation of a movie as part of the syllabus. So when movies were introduced for the first time, there was a hue and cry like this, because many believe that why should we have movies in the syllabus? Because it is for entertainment. The same was incorporated into this because, you know, we have a concept like cultural studies. I think I told you, it is an umbrella term which incorporates into its purview every discipline, every possible discipline, whether it is advertising, whether it is comic strips, whether it is graphic novels, television advertisements, pop music, whatnot, you know, everything is part of it. Cartoons, everything. So that is why don't be scared of PLT. It is not there to scare you. Or don't be a hardcore traditionalist who cries out saying that, you know, literature marichu, popular literature ne konnu onnu vane karayanalla idu. It is introduced to make you understand that these forms which were traditionally excluded from the mainstream literature, it should be part and parcel of literature. They should also be there. It's a very accommodative kind of a thing. So that is why I told you it is an inclusion. It is inclusion and not exclusion. So when you say that these things are here and these things should be kept away, we are making it's a crime that we are doing to all these art forms. So that is why it is actually giving recognition to diverse voices in literature. So look at it from that way. Don't be scared of... you shouldn't be scared of PLT in literature. In fact, you should be feeling very happy that you have a well-balanced kind of a syllabus where you learn canon and also popular literature side by side. So, don't...
Okay, thank you, ma'am.
Shabri, is there any more questions?
Yes, a few more questions, I think. I think some more, two or three questions.
Okay.
Hi, ma'am. Myself, Shahina Bivi, from last year English Literature. So how far do you think comics are of powerful canons of popular literature? Like when we consider Persepolis by Marjane Satrapi, which is a more powerful impact than numerous novels, films, and short fiction. Even teensilum, youthilum, polum, it has a great influence. So it has a wider reach and better reception. So what do you think about that?
I think comics have got a long history of resistance and survival, okay? Because, you know, when a long story is cut short into a comic, It is and also the impact of a picture, impact of a subtle dialogue is very, very powerful than a long winded sentence, because that is why we have punch dialogues in movies. Just imagine, you know, like Basha oru thadava sonna nooru thadava sonna madiri, just expand it, you know, it sounds comical. So it is a punch dialogue because of the minimality of things that has been expressed. That's again one of the features of a comic. So that is why, you know, when you look at it from a perspective, like Percy Pulse that you have mentioned, it actually sums up a lot of concepts into a small strip. And that, I think, is the greatest challenge for the writer also. So the moment you say, you undermine a writer by saying, oh, he's a comic writer, we are making a disservice to the whole, what you call, the concept of literature. Because to accommodate everything into a small strip, you know, he has to make a lot of sacrifices. So a lot of insight goes into the making of a comic strip. And also the impact of a comic strip is much more than a long-winded sentence or, you know, maybe essays or, you know, political discourses. And that's one of the reasons why political cartoons have, at one point of time, especially during our freedom struggle, they were the, what you call, weapons of resistance for Indians. Because, you know, in one picture, they could capture an entire movement, maybe Quit India movement or Jalian Wala Bagh or something like that. They could actually incorporate into that. So, you know, of course, they are wonderful forms of literature. I'll always love to, like, for instance, you know, when Beatles, when they started creating their songs, the lyrics was written by themselves, and they were considered to be pop songs, so it was actually kept at a different level altogether. But look at the lyrics of this songs, or just look at the lyrics of some of the Malayalam songs that we sing, or Tamil songs or Hindi songs. They are sheer poetry. You cannot dismiss them by saying they are film songs. At one point of time, film songs were considered to be the film song. But ONV-ye kurichokke parayunnathanne anganeyanu nalla kavi aayirunnu pakshe endinana cinema paattu ezhuthan poyenna nanu choichathu pakshe ippo adhe ezhuthiya pole ulla cinema paattukal ennu nammal maatti nirthunna paattukalude athrayum manoharamalla adhethinte pala kavithakalum namukku sraddhikkan ariyam appo kavithayum cinema paattum thammil vyathyasam undo ennu cheyyunna chila samayathonnum illa ഞാൻ പറയുന്നത് ഇപ്പൊ നമ്മുടെ ഒമർ ലുലു കൈൻഡ് ഓഫ് മൂവീസിലെ പാട്ടുകളെ കുറിച്ചല്ല. സോ ദാറ്റ് ഇസ് ഇറ്റ്. സോ വെൻ യു ആക്ച്വലി മേക്ക് എ കൈൻഡ് ഓഫ് എ ഡിഫറൻസ് ഓർ മേക്ക് എ ഡിസ്റ്റിങ്ഷൻ ബിറ്റ്വീൻ കാർട്ടൂൺസ് ആൻഡ് വെൻ യു സേ ദാറ്റ് ഇറ്റ് ഇസ് നോട്ട് പാർട്ട് ഓഫ് ലിറ്ററേച്ചർ, യു ആർ മേക്കിംഗ് യു ആർ ഡൂയിങ് എ ക്രൈം. ഓഫ് കോഴ്സ് പേഴ്സി പോൾസ് ഇസ് മച്ച് ഇറ്റ്സ് ഇമ്പാക്ട് ഇസ് വെരി മച്ച് ആൻഡ് യു ഷുഡ് റീഡ് മോർ ആൻഡ് മോർ ഓഫ് ഇറ്റ്. സോ ഐ വിൽ ഓൾവേസ് അഡ്വക്കേറ്റ് ഓൾ ദിസ്. കോമിക്സ് ആർ എ wonderful way of expression in literature, and it's very nice that, you know, they have finally made its way into the syllabus. That's it. Yes,
thank you, ma'am. I have one more question for you, ma'am. So can you please mention about Calvin and Hobbes comic strip by Bill Watterson, which is the most philosophical cartoon of all time? I think each comic strip in a text is a text in itself, so can you please mention about it?
You, Calvin and Hobbes, and I somehow find that, you know, these questions are directly influenced by your teacher Shabarinath, because, you know, he loves Calvin and Hobbes. I know that. See, Calvin and Hobbes is actually a great vision. Okay, a stuffed animal talking to the boy, and what is the stuffed animal saying? Great philosophical questions in a nutshell, and not very boring in the sense. You know that one of the problems with philosophy is that it is it actually gives the impression, or it gives the manifestation that, you know, an ordinary person cannot understand. You know, it gives you, see, suppose you say that I am a philosopher, I am reading philosophy, it gives the impression that you are a very serious person. Okay, but look at the way Calvin and Hobbes treats philosophy in a very, what you call, light-hearted way, but at the same time it teaches you many things about life, and especially about how to enjoy life. Because there are so many conversations where the stuffed animal, which is not real, all of us have got this, what you call, stuffed animals, or what you call, toys with which you had conversations as a child. In fact, Osho calls God as a psychological teddy bear, because, you know, he doesn't exist, But, you know, it's a psychologically, it's a teddy bear. You know, teddy bear gives you that, you know, very cozy feeling that, you know, something warm is to be hugged, you know, the fluffy feeling. So that is exactly the feeling that, you know, Calvin and Hobbes, emulate. You have a person who is not real, but still that is a one person who knows your innermost secrets. And what kinds of secrets? It's not the secrets that, you know, it's like, you know, ISIS with Cherinan Varayan, the secrets are low. It is the greatest visions that you have, the small dreams that you have, the way they travel. See, if you look at Calvin and Hobson, is one of my, I'll just die for them, you know, the trio. And as a child, I've always longed that, God, please give me, at that time, you know, we have prayers in school. I used to think of me having something like, you know, that there's a stuffed toy who will walk with me, talk with me, and advise me. You know, you find there are so many advices given by the tiger. Okay, so and it is only after a while that I realized it was not real. You know, the tiger is not real, but it doesn't make a difference. So it is philosophy. Okay, it is not comic strip. It is just philosophy, pure philosophy, sheer philosophy. Just like, you know, the piglet and the poo, you know, they have conversations. And one of my favorite conversations that they make is, you know, you will die one day. Then he tells, no, we'll all die one day, but we live the other days. You know, like, I think it's a wonderful philosophy. So they are philosophies. Okay, even the peanut strip, you know, Charles Schulz, you know, they are all philosophy. They are not just, you cannot dismiss them as a comic strip. They teach you a lot. They teach you to become lovely human beings. I love them. Please read Calvin and Hobbes. They are awesome. And I know Shabari is behind all these questions. I know.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Good afternoon, madam.
Good afternoon, Shabari.
Madam, my question is, actually it's not a question, but a series of comments, because I was forced to teach this paper. There is this new syllabus division and the new structuring, the restructuring of the syllabus from this semester. And many students have a feeling that they're being made a scapegoat of the new fantasies of this Kerala University. And even a parent came to me and asked me, what is the relevance of studying a topic, a novel like Charlie and Chocolate Factory by Roald Dahl in today's era? So we, even not just me, but many teachers, my colleagues, we all get perplexed by these questions. And the biggest issue is that we cannot explain it in a single sentence. So that is the biggest challenge. Yeah. So my question is, in this paper we have Tintin and Tintin in Tibet, we have Harry Potter, we have Zoya Factor, we have Sherlock Holmes all coming back, which were all not part of the canon sometime back. These were all considered to be out of the syllabus, which were to be read as a private in a private reading, maybe in a library. And you would be ashamed to say that in a public or a literary debate or a literary seminar. But now we are coming up with these topics are part of the mainstream syllabus. Students can read it in the class. We can discuss it in the class. So my question is, who decides the inclusiveness and exclusiveness of these topics? Which are the popular, which are the mainstream, which are to be included, which are not to be included? That's the one first question by me. And again, I see that whenever there is a resurgence or a revival of these topics in the Western media, let us take the case of Sherlock Holmes. Sherlock Holmes was supposed to be not relevant in today's era. It was supposed to be a figment of imagination of a writer who lived in the Victorian era. But when the BBC series on Sherlock came up, there was suddenly a revival in Sherlock. There were even papers on Sherlock, PhD thesis on Sherlock. Even in our Kerala University, under our Pro VC, Ajayumar sir, one of my juniors is doing a PhD on Mohanlal. We cannot believe that. We cannot even imagine that. And he is doing it in Kerala University. And his thesis is on Mohanlal. So in this, and also there is another issue, the students who see that they don't like Roald Dahl, my question is, will they read a classic novel by Charles Dickens named David Copperfield, which is about 1,100 pages long? That's the question. So I think often the hesitation from the students, or maybe an inhibition against this popular literature and culture, is not just at these novels, but a part of a general hesitation to read novels or whatever literature, and living in an era of instant gratification where we are consumed by YouTube and Instagram and all these things, where our attention doesn't hold on to more than a few seconds or a minute, where we scroll from one page to another. I think that is the main problem. As Speaker Rajasekharan said, we have to regain the text. We have to read the text. We have to go back to the text. I think maybe that's why Bob Dylan got the Nobel Prize for Literature. Maybe the Nobel Committee themselves felt that the very notion, the very definition of literature itself needs a restructuring. So can you comment on a few points?
I think you have asked the question and you have answered the questions yourself. So I think the job will be very bare minimum. Regarding the first question, that is who decides? Now that becomes that's actually very problematic kind of a thing, because at one point of time it was decided by, I think I told you, religion determined it. Canon was actually religious in nature. So if a church tells you these are the things that you can read and these are the things that you shouldn't be read, it shouldn't be read, it becomes a canon. You know how Martin Luther revolted against that and so on. So whatever it is, there was always been a revolt against a canon, which is actually as old as civilization. So canon was one time, it was religious in nature, but now it is political in nature. So you find that, when a board of studies is being formed, I always call board of studies as board of studies, okay? Because I don't know what exactly makes them select some books over the other. So it is actually a political body. It is determined by a certain ideology by which they abide by. I'll give you an example, not from literature, but from political theory and economics. You know that Marxism is an integral part of any political discourses or economic discourses. Even in literature, it is an integral part. Now, forget about the political dimensions that it offers, taking it from the what you call looking at it from a very, what you call, something that which determines a political change or anything. If you look at Marxism from that point of view, it is a very relevant theory. It is something that which was very important. You have to understand how, when you start reading Marxism, you will understand how the global politics have determined our consumerist attitudes, how it is making us all consumers, how it is making us products being sold. You know that if you're not the commodity, you are the product being, if you're not buying anything from the Amazon, you are the product being sold. You know that, many have mentioned that, Feldman and others have talked about it. So whatever it is, you just ask any student who is studying in Kerala University, where does Marxism feature? It is actually at the fag end of the syllabus, maybe perhaps as a paragraph, and they immediately go to other concepts like communism, socialism, and so on, and diverge it like that. This is a clear intervention of the board of studies or people who have been deciding what has to be read. It is a part of a global agenda where this is being excluded, and slowly things which challenges, which provides a resistance, is being just eroded. You don't find these kind of voices, and you always find a dominant agenda being circulated. That is why one of the things that always the policymakers, a government always does, is to hamper with the education system by the syllabus. That is why you have, though you actually say a lot of things against this, you still will have to comply with these agendas made by the government. We are facing that. We are actually victims of that. So who decides? Politics determines it. So whichever party is in power, they are the ones who actually tell them what has to be read. That's one of the reasons why you find a lot of essays by Nehru and Indira Gandhi and others were there in the older syllabus. But since they were exemplary essays, since they addressed the cultural plurality of India, this was not a problem. So, but look at the kind of things that they have to study in the present day syllabus. You find a clear agenda in that. And that is why we have to make a even when you are teaching all that, we have to tell them, see, this is part of your syllabus, therefore I'm forced to teach you. But there is always another voice. So teachers have a great role in that. Especially young lecturers like you have a great role in actually maintaining that. So bringing up the voice of resistance, bringing up the voice of dissent, as Romila Thapar tells in her latest book, you know, how dissent was actually part of Indian culture, Indian tradition. But how, you know, we have now associated dissent being, you know, very an improper thing, especially in the academia. The people who dissent, people who raise their voice, people who question, people who challenge, they are actually considered to be not up to the mark. We want obedience and allegiance everywhere. So that's actually the reason why you have syllabus is actually a body which is determined by a selected few members. And politics determines it. And it has nothing to do with academics. You know, it is never a representative kind of a thing. It is just, you know, haphazardly collected and, you know, put together. It is never an inclusive kind of a thing. That is one of the reasons why when you have a syllabus, it is always better to go beyond the syllabus. In fact, one of my teachers used to conduct beyond the syllabus program where, you know, it is outside the syllabus. You go outside. So it's up to the students, you know, you cannot have, because we are not policy makers. We are not in the government to actually make these kind of things. So it is up to you to decide what the student will have to think of. So it's in the hand of teachers. And when you have very enterprising teachers like you, it works. And if not, it doesn't work.
Thank you. So thank you, ma'am. Thank you. Yeah, I think that says it all. Maybe that's why Stanford University has the biggest collection of Tamil pulp literature and not an Indian university, the Stanford University, UK. So maybe the change is coming in, setting in, maybe with the new semester. I think it's time for us to wind up our webinar. Can we have a last question, a short question, a quick question?
Yeah, please.
Anyone?
Good afternoon, ma'am.
Good afternoon.
Ma'am, my name is Shrikala, and I am one of the faculty members in Department of English.
Okay.
So I'm currently handling Harry Potter. So I am a person who was, started reading after Harry Potter. So my question is simple, ma'am. Actually, they are teaching these white people's stories and all other things, among other things, to an audience who are not familiar with the basics of references. So how can we frame these stories? And also in case of Harry Potter, which has a very active media extension to it, how can we balance the representation of the book and the media? And also how can we break out the label of popular? Because it is not actually popular. It is upon us to make that popular among the students. So it is upon to us. So how can we, can you offer some pointers on that matter?
Now, it's actually the problem is that you are teaching popular literature in a paper titled Popular Literature to a group of people who have who are not new to or who are oblivious to the differences that exist between popular and canonical literature. Just imagine for a first year degree student, he is just coming to the class after his plus two reading habits, which must be exclusively about Harry Potter, and when he comes to the class, he is reading Harry Potter. So he might get a feeling that this is canon. That's natural that the child will have this feeling that, you know, this is canon, and this is something which, you know, we'll have to break. We'll have to tell them this is not canon, because there is nothing this is actually part of popular literature. It is something that which is widely read, widely recognized. Youngsters read it. It is a leisure kind of reading. And as somebody pointed out, it is instant gratification of desires. It is escape reading. Now, this is part of it. There is another set of reading which is more serious, or maybe which demands our attention, time, and our patience. That is there. So the difference has to be made clear. The other thing is that, now, whenever you teach something, especially we are teachers of British literature, and we naturally will have to encounter so many concepts which are alien to our Indian culture. For instance, Thanksgiving Day. We don't have Thanksgiving Day. So it doesn't mean that the child will get confused over Thanksgiving Day. It only means that, you know, they'll get exposed to different cultures and concepts. Literature is all about understanding different cultures and unity in diversity. You call that, you know, you understand different cultures that exist in different places. But unfortunately, since we are studying English literature, we are exposed to a dominant English culture, which has its hierarchical structures and, you know, dominant ideology intact. That is one of the reasons I told you Arnold wanted to make sure that this dominant culture remains like that. This hierarchical structure remains like that. That is why he talked about the high culture, and he derided everything that was not part of it. He called it as a populace and so on. So anyway, so when you're teaching it, the cultural context never matches. When we are very small, we had textbooks where you have concepts like apple pie pudding. We don't know. But instead of that, you know, some educationist said, instead of apple pie pudding, why can't the educationers introduce kanni? See, that anganeyokkulla valare idiotic statements parnittund chela fruits ne ipa peaches nu parayumbodhekku maybe the child cannot relate to pakshe chakka nu parayumba ariya ennokku parnittu ee education de maatra oru process ne bhayangaramayittu localize cheyyunna oru pravanada enikku thira oru abhigami ayittu thonnilla because you know that is not actually the end and all of learning. See, when you are learning something, you are introduced to that culture also. That is why we have books that have been translated from different languages. If you have to read only our culture, our vision and so on, we could have been happily reading only Malayalam books. Why do we actually read translated books from different cultures? Why do we read Dostoevsky? Why do we read Victor Hugo? Why do we read all these cultures? Because, you know, it is this multiplicity of cultures, the multicultural attitude that makes an individual a universal citizen. Otherwise we will be like, you know, you are born into a culture and we'll die in that culture. That's ridiculous, because every culture has got its share of you know, goodness and, you know, maybe craziness and so on. To understand all that is actually part and parcel of reading literature. That is why I told you it's a very inclusive kind of a project. Being a literature student is actually a very inclusive kind of an idea. It is not restricting yourself to saying that, you know, my family, my culture, my glorious past and so on. So it's a very, you know, outdated idea. So we shouldn't be falling prey to that. So when you're teaching Harry Potter, tell them that this is, again, what it stands for. Just like when we are teaching Tempest, you know, you talk about this is what it is. Caliban now talks back. You know, it's actually about post-colonial. The whole concept of the empire talking back is taken from a play which was set in what you call Elizabethan era. Just imagine. So when Caliban talks back to Prospero, you can actually club it with every nation which was offering their resistance to the dominant culture that was trying to make them slaves. Whether it is India, whether it is Africa, it's the same story. So that is why even within literature, you have instances of resistance or instances of talking back. So that we have to address. That a student may not be able to identify because they are very raw to it. They're very naive to it, okay? But a teacher knows that. So that is why I told you, if you can just match up all this, fill up all the places, place everything in order, you can actually tackle this issue of cultural incongruities in a very, very effective manner. So when a child is reading Harry Potter, he's not just reading Harry Potter, he's reading a lot of idea about school, about the working of an institution, about a principal, and what happens when a principal goes behaves in a particular way. There are so many things that are involved: friendship, jealousy, growing up, the sense of growing up, awakening of sexual sensibilities. All these things are part of Harry Potter series. So you cannot limit them to being a magical novel. So by saying that, you know, clubbing everything, what is Harry Potter all about? It's a magical novel, a magical series. We are limiting ourselves. But just by saying, what is Game of Thrones? Oh, it's a series. It's a long series. You'll have to wait for it. You are limiting yourself. So try to be very accommodative, try to be very inclusive, so that the pitfalls that you associated with, you know, with having only a dominant voice is being restricted. So that is why when you teach Harry Potter, try to tell them that, you know, this is just one part of the world. It's just a part of a dominant
Okay, thank you, ma'am. It was very insightful. Thank you.
Thank you, Srikala.
hope it's over. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much for kindling our hearts with such an enthusiasm. Thank you so much for being with us. So I think it's time. Best and beautiful things in the world cannot be seen or even touched. They must be felt by heart. Thank you is one such prayer. So let me invite Shabrinath S., Assistant Professor of English, for the vote of thanks.
Good afternoon, all. So to speak honestly, to say it honestly, my thirst has not yet been quenched. I would like to have another couple of hours to discussion, and the discussion never ends here. It just goes on to our minds. And if we are fortunate, we will have maybe a second part of this discussion, maybe in the subsequent months, ma'am. We will be calling you. And so it's time to wind up. I thank our respected principal, Dr. K.C. George, and our Reverend Father, Joseph Chacko, Administrator GCAs. They have been, their support and their help have been indispensable in organizing a function like this, especially in a time of pandemic. I also thank Mrs. Kaikasi V.S., our Kaikasi Madam, Assistant Professor of English, University College Trivandrum, for having spared her valuable time and having spent some time with us and sharing all these pearls of wisdom for our students who have been perplexed by this sudden change in syllabus from the university. Also for thanking, maybe sharing a few points for us, the enlightening us. I also thank our head of the department, Dr. R. Gopakumar, without whose help, nothing would have been possible. He has always been our overlord, our guiding light, our mentor. Thank you, sir. I also thank Dr. Philip, HOD Economics, Dr. Sheila Madam, HOD History, Carolyn Madam, HOD in Charge Commerce, Dr. Raju, HOD Psychology. And I also thank all my dear colleagues. I also thank, last but not the least, I would like to thank the organizing committee consisting of Anjana Arbi, Srikala, Jafar Sir, Shanti, Nice Mary, George Bertel. And I would like to thank all my dear students who have been very patiently listening to this webinar online. I thank everybody from my behalf and the behalf of the whole department and the college. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Every story has an ending, but in life, every ending is a beginning. On behalf of the Department of English, I extend my heartfelt gratitude to all for your participation. Win the morning, win your day. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, teacher.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.